Oh, so are we on the internet?
It takes a moment, Chuck.
Oh, are we live?
Yeah.
Probably. Somewhere, anywhere along here.
Oh, good.
Me explaining how going online works.
Yeah.
The alert on my phone has not gone off. Oh, there it is. Never mind.
Whoop, there it is.
It's gone off. The alert has gone off. We're live.
Can one of you tall fuckers turn the fan on?
Oh.
Ooh, switch to night mode in YouTube gaming.
What?
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 I want to go to night mode.
Working on night mode.
Yeah,
it is hot as fuck in here.
Yeah, man.
Or it could be all the gin.
Yeah,
I've crammed in
I
my
believe
face.
The gin.
Yeah.
Oh hell yeah!
Yeah.
Bonus fan.
Double fan. We have
only
two
for Patreon subscribers.
Oh, is that us?
Yeah.
Mm.
We get. Actually, I am.
Check it out, animated gin.
It's pronounced gin.
I was gonna say. That's what I always say. Because you know what, I don't say either of them. I don't think either of them's correct.
Okay.
But I enjoy doing that. Like whenever anyone says animated GIF, I go, actually, it's a GIF.
Yes.
And then if someone calls it an animated GIF, I say, well, actually, it's a GIF.
I do the same thing.
Yeah.
Drives people insane.
But then you know, but at least with the GIF one, you go, oh, would you like a glass of gin?
Mm-hmm.
And they go, oh, well, it's graphic interchange format, not graphic. I'm like, you got
it's it's giraffe
interchange format.
Yeah, also you don't live in a Hughes, so you're wrong, Texas.
I want to go to a Hughes.
Oh man, the Mighty Peking Man poster covers the Gremlin.
Oh, I'm sorry.
Oh, it's shit. Okay.
You want to put the Gremlin up here?
Do you want me to make
here,
put in there.
Do you want
here,
me to make the poster
the
less mighty?
Here, tall man,
it's
put those back on the shelf.
Look at how small it is. What?
The wrestling episode is over. Put those back on the shelf.
Oh, wait, where were they on the shelf?
Whee! Next to the apple lady and her knockers.
Oh, man.
My apple lady.
I got that reference. Yeah. It hurts me when I shave.
Y'all should tweet. I tweeted.
Oh, shit. Oh, shit, tweet!
Hey, don't tell me what to do.
Okay, bro.
All right, thanks.
Sorry, bro.
What is this tweet?
What is this tweet?
What? It's tweet. What is it?
I don't see it. Where is it?
It references Jessica Lange.
Lange. It's pronounced Lange.
Oh, Lange.
Lange.
Langy. Jess Lanky.
Wait, how...
What?
I mean, congratulations, Steve, but I thought... Are you still in high school? I thought he was done. Oh, no, he just turned 18. He can still be in high school and be 18.
Or he could have just asked a high school lady to prom.
Well, that's true. That's true.
I know I ain't in school no more, but you want to go to prom, lady?
That's acceptable for like a year or two.
Oh, so I shouldn't do it is what you're saying?
No.
Okay.
No, Chuck.
All right, then.
There are various proms for adults that you can ask pretty ladies to.
Yeah, I think it's called Saturday.
Yes.
You can go dance and get drunk.
Cool.
Any Saturday.
They also put on, like, nerd proms and goth proms and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Sometimes they're really sad.
Pro tip for you, Chuck, and anyone older than Steve, half your age plus 8.
That's what I thought it was 7.
7.
7?
7.
Yeah.
Wait, what?
Half plus 8. 7?
7.
If you're a little bit younger than us, then you should probably... Ah, shit, I don't know. Yeah, you should probably go 8. You should probably go 8 just to be safe.
Yeah, just go 8.
Half your age plus 7, unless it's under the legal age of consent, and then round up to the legal age of consent.
There's still a little sticky wicket there. Like, if you're 19...
Oh,
I'm just saying, if you're 19, you can date a 17-year-old. That's not that
weird. Yeah, just be careful about your jurisdiction.
Yeah, you just can't
consent.
Fuck. Or you'll get arrested.
Yes.
Unless you're in Alabama, and then they're like, hey, man.
Check your local legislation.
Yeah. So anyway, speaking of being old enough...
to fuck?
Sure. today's live stream, drink.
Yeah.
We are having Tom Collins.
This was my idea.
Tom Collins
request.
I requested a Tom Collins.
And I prepared them.
He did. And he did a damn good job because they're tasty.
Yeah. And I bought the ingredients.
Yes.
Mackie.
So I feel like I
bought the ingredients.
I didn't do shit.
You hosted. You provided the glassware.
The bar is where the things landed.
Okay.
Yeah, man, you got a full bar going here.
Mm-hmm.
We didn't even crack open the Zaya yet.
Nope.
Yeah.
I was kind of itching to drink some of that, but I was like, I've never had a Tom Collins.
Yeah. So in case you're wondering how to make a Tom Collins, it is...
Go on.
Two parts gin, like 3/4 of a part of lemon juice, a couple tablespoons of simple syrup, some ice,
Club soda.
Club soda. Garnish with a lemon swath and a maraschino cherry, and then, you know, ice and shit in there.
I'm looking forward to that gin-soaked cherry that's at the bottom of this sucker.
Yes.
Almost as good as the bourbon-soaked cherry from the old-fashioned.
I'm looking for the gin-soaked barroom queen in Memphis.
Hmm.
So anyway, drink a Tom Collins once in your life. It's a delicious drink. Buy yourself some good gin. Put it in your bar. Drink it.
Put it in your bar.
Put it in your bar.
Don't buy like Tanqueray or Beefeater. It's super dry and it ruins it ruins your night. Buy something
Tanqueray.
Like New Amsterdam or Plymouth or Hendrix.
It's pronounced New York.
What about
even
Sapphire?
Old New York was once New York. Was once New Amsterdam.
Bombay Sapphire is
Walt left a bottle of that at my house and on my birthday.
You know, I'm not a real big fan of Bombay Sapphire. I think it's overpriced for what it is. They have a Bombay Sapphire East or something that's a little bit different. It's got a little bit more botanicals in it as opposed to the straight-ass dry London juniper gin.
Yeah.
So I like that a little bit better. Bombay Sapphire is just, I don't know, it's blue, whoop-de-doo. Yeah. That's my opinion of it.
The only reason I like Beefeater is because you can say, it's Beefeater!
Fun fact, when I was 14, 15, and going around London and drinking because they don't really care, the Beefeater is it's named after the gin. It's a chain of bars.
Oh.
And they would not serve us. They were like the only ones. You go to any hole-in-the-wall pub, and they're just like, we don't fucking care, but they were like...
As long as you could see over the bar, you could drink.
Pretty much, yeah.
Yeah, were you like, fuck yeah, you fucking wankers! Yeah.
Go back to England. Oh, wait.
Yeah, fucking beef eaters.
That doesn't work.
No wonder Yoss is a big one.
Yeah. They all be speaking German.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
That really just works for just about anyone that's not American.
Yep.
I mean, including America if the Nazis had won. But
right.
It's just fun to walk around pretty much the entire world and say, you'd all be speaking German.
If it wasn't for me.
Yes, me personally.
Yeah, me.
Man.
Yep.
Mighty Peking Man.
Chuck's already lit.
I know. Chuck's chugging. Look at him. He's halfway down.
He likes Tom
Collins. Yeah, lit AF. That's Chuck.
Let me tell you a Tom Collins story.
Oh, please do.
This is the first alcohol I ever drank in my life.
Yeah.
It was at the Christmas party of the television station where I worked, and we had already all been fired. So I said, the booze was free, so I was like, I'm going to drink as many of these as I can and find out what kind of drunk I am, because fuck all these people. If I turn out to be an asshole, I don't care.
Now,
what kind of drunk did you turn out to be that night?
I am the happiest drunk. Everyone knew I loved them.
All the people that you hate.
I'm curious. Mm-hmm. You say that was the first alcohol you ate. How old were you? Or ate, drank. How old were you?
I would have been 25.
Wow. Jesus.
Man.
Wow.
Yeah.
Were you like raised in a fundamentalist
home? Not at all.
Home?
I was just straight edge, yo.
Man. I remember my first drink when I was like 14.
Yeah.
Yeah, hanging out in the woods near my friend's house. Yeah. We had a warm bottle of Svedka.
Yeah, drink some MD 2020.
Yeah, don't drink Svedka, even especially warm.
So on that England trip, like one of the first times I got good and actually drunk, we were staying in the Hotel Lily, and we figured out how to get up on the roof and hung out up there and listened to music and got drunk. And then found out years later that was the same place that the Doors got on the roof and got drunk in London.
That's pretty good.
Didn't know that at the time. I wasn't like, hey, let's be like Jim Morrison.
I'd wager you could go anywhere in London, and that's where the Doors
another are. Weird Doors correlation. Mm-hmm. My friend that went to FSU stayed in the same dorm as Jim Morrison.
Whoa.
It's the only one if you go to Tallahassee and all the dorm buildings look the same, except there's one that has like barbed wire fence up on the roof. Because several people over the years have been like, Jim Morrison, talk to me. Weep.
So it's like those Foxconn plants in China.
Just like that.
Sure.
Yes.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
They didn't put the nets. They just put, please don't climb up this.
Oh, they just, like, if you're going to do this, you're going to mutilate yourself first.
Yeah.
As opposed to, we'll just catch you lightly.
Yeah. Okay. This is weird coincidences of Doors experiences.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Mm. Anywho.
Yeah.
Let's talk about Mighty Peaking, man.
25.
25.
God.
Yeah.
Man. By the time I was 25, I was like, I need to stop drinking.
Yeah. I'd already had that, like, I've never drinking again experience several times. Yeah.
No. And I've never had a hangover.
Oh, you're missing out, Chuck.
Man, drink up. Mm-hmm. We'll get you a hangover.
Well, you give me 8 more of these, and then we'll see.
Yeah, we can make that sort of happen. Shit, I like
that. But I ran out of drink tickets, and I was like going to getting other people's drink tickets. I was like, hey, you going to use that? I could have another Tom Collins if you give me that.
Hey, listen.
But see, it's good to be a friendly drunk.
Listen, absolutely. You don't know me. My name's Chuck. And
I know a few like angry drunks, and they are the fucking worst. Mm-hmm. Like
angry drunks and clingy drunks.
Those are the only times I've gotten in fights are angry drunks.
Clingy drunk.
And this was
maybe
the...
you were the angry drunk.
That's the thing. That's the problem. I'm Mr. Friendly Drunk, but...
And this was my first exposure to the whole rule of life of the people who don't want or need electronics win them at the holiday raffle.
Oh,
absolutely.
Every time, like, we had, like, they were giving away a Dreamcast and a PlayStation 2 and, like, the first flat screen TV. And, like, the.
Was it one of those Sony Vega?
Yeah.
Enormous 6,000 pound TVs?
It was still a tube TV, but.
Right.
Mm-hmm.
So it was just a flat. Front panel.
Flat screen.
Right.
Yeah.
Not flat panel.
Yeah, right. No. And no, it always went to the secretary who was like 80 and, you know, was like, oh, I think I have a grandkid who likes the Dreamcast.
My nephew might like this.
Yeah. And we're all the engineers are just like, fuck, we could just plug that in right now.
Yep. So. It's always the way, man.
Mm-hmm. Goddamn old biddies.
Yeah. Drink.
Should we do a podcast?
Yeah.
Light this candle.
Podcast.
All right, and welcome to the Bamfcast.
Hey, Bamfcast.
Episode 370.
Ooh.
Whoa.
Yeah.
Whoa.
Yeah. So I'm Harlow.
I'm Mackie.
I'm BJ.
I'm Chuck.
And what we do each and every episode of the Bamfcast is we go and we watch ourselves a quote-unquote bad movie, come in here and talk about it for the first half, and then we rate them. Good bad movies, enjoyable bad movies. They get 1 to 5 jocks as robot jocks.
Robot jocks.
Good job, robot jocks.
However, there are bad movies, and so stay away. They get a negative sliding scale. 1 to 5 bags as in douchebags after Twilight.
Boo. Ooh.
Bad job, Twilight.
Get out of here, Twilight.
Meh.
So guess what, guys?
What?
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 It's April.
Oh, the guy doing the intro told me that.
April?
Yeah.
April.
It's time for some monkey movies.
Yeah.
Some monkey shines.
I remember this. We did this before.
We have done this before. First up is a little movie from 1977 called Mighty Peking Man.
Yeah.
Or Goliathon.
Goliathon's a pretty good title.
Some other true. Names, I think, too.
Mm-hmm.
But we know it as Mighty Peking Man, and that's what we watched.
Okay.
Let's do a quick plot summary and get that out of the way.
Oh, all right.
It's a very quick one. Word of a monster ape, 10 stories tall, living in the Himalayas, reaches fortune hunters in Hong Kong. They travel to India to capture it, but wild animals and quicksand dissuade all but Johnny, an adventurer with a broken heart.
He does. Yeah. It is so
he just
broken.
Wanted to get away.
Yeah.
Full disclosure, we watched this with dubs.
Yes.
I know some people are already, like, twitching. Their eyes are twitching right now.
No.
But you know what? When we're all together and having a good time and laughing over the movie, it's hard to keep up with subtitles. I mean, we'll be honest. When we're watching a movie for the sake of, like, single person and, you know, intake, I think we pretty much all go subs.
Correct.
Mm-hmm.
It's true. Yeah.
But in a group, it's kind of more fun. And sometimes this adds to a layer of, like, the stupidity of the movies that we watch.
Yeah.
But strange little crossover. This is a Shaw Brothers movie.
Yeah, it is.
So if you've been paying any attention to Bamfcast Extra... Chuck and I have been watching a few of those.
We knew what to expect.
Yeah. Well, sort of, because...
Well, this is, I think, only the second official Shaw Brothers movie on Bamfcast Prime, because Super Inframan from pre-Chuck days,
yes,
we did.
Two and a half, because Cleopatra Jones and the Casino of Gold was a Shaw co-production.
That's right.
That's true, yeah.
So.
But yeah, so it's a little bit of a crossover there, and... You say it's, you know, we knew what we were expecting, but this is, for a Shaw Brothers movie, this is fairly high budget and also full of locations and not just like a soundstage.
And no kung fu whatsoever.
No, no, none.
Yeah. Zero.
But basically the Shaw brothers were like, hey, you seen King Kong? We can do that.
Yeah. And we should.
And we should.
And we will.
And we will.
And they did.
Mission accomplished.
Uh-huh. Yeah. I mean, this one's probably going to be a little bit weird to talk about because it so closely resembles the plot line of King Kong that...
Yeah.
Kind of pretty much is. We can talk about some of the idiosyncratic moments along the way, but yeah, plot point for plot point, it's almost the same.
Yeah, I mean, the movie starts and we get like, we're seeing like native village in the Himalayas and there's basically a voiceover, or I think it was a text on the screen.
The researchers are in a library and they're like, check out this headline, and then it pushes into the headline and then it's in the past.
Right. Yeah, and it's like the earth opened and...
The mighty Peking man came out and smashed everything to shit.
Yeah, he pretty much came out pissed off at these villagers for no particular reason, but just whatever.
How dare you?
Fuck some shit up.
Live here.
Killed some people.
Yeah.
But eventually they retreated into a temple, and he tried to break his way in and kind of was just like, ah, fuck it.
Mm-hmm.
So tired.
Yep. And the story ended there, and the researchers were like, well, if this is true, we could go there and get him and bring him to Hong Kong, and it'll be, people will pay to see it. It'll be great.
Because that always works out.
No bad thing could happen from that.
God, it's like these bitches didn't even see King Kong.
No, I don't think they did.
I bet they didn't.
It probably hadn't gotten there by then.
Bet they read about King Kong, but...
But yeah, so they're like, well, who's going to lead this crazy expedition? Oh, I know this guy named Johnny. He just left his girl.
he left his girl, and he needs to get away.
Yeah.
And it turns out Johnny is... Well, he's Inspector Lee in The Killer, which is like one of the best action movies of all time. And if you haven't watched that, you should fucking watch it. But yeah, I think he's also in Super Inframan as well. Yes,
he's the star of Super Inframan.
Yeah, I was going to say.
He is Inframan.
Yeah, but he is passed out drunk at a bar. And they wake him up and they're like, hey, you want to go to the jungle? Get away? And he's like, yeah, sure.
It's like, you guys are awesome, man. Let's go to the jungle. So they do.
Mm-hmm.
Straight to the jungle.
This movie doesn't waste much time at all.
Nope. It's they do try to kind of show off the scope of their movie, and it's like a lot of just traveling to location. Mm-hmm. It's like, look, we've got these yaks or whatever they are, and we've piled stuff on them.
They have like eight carts with being, led by two yaks each. I mean, for again, for a Shaw Brothers movie, this is kind of crazy. I mean, I know you look at it like now and you're like, wow, this is so low budget, but you haven't probably seen too many other Shaw Brothers movies because they're usually just all soundstage.
Yes.
That's why we were shocked. Like, our first one, besides the other ones we've seen for Banff Gas Prime, we started with Killer Constable, and it's like, there's outside shots, there's like shots by water, and we were like, oh, this is cool. And then we started watching all the other ones, and it's like,
it's nothing but studio.
Nothing but soundstage stuff, like maybe like a shot or two outside.
Yeah. Well, this one, I mean, they go to the village that was in the beginning that, obviously they reshot later and trashed. But they get to this village and they're just like, hello, anybody? Who's here? Is there anybody here? And
there's some people there, but they're not people.
No, they're elephants.
That's not really people at all, Chuck.
You're right, it's not, but I instantly corrected myself.
Yeah. Sure. But yeah, the elephants are just like, oh, this place is laid unspoiled for 1,000 years. Time to fucking wreck it.
Yep.
Because for some reason, the elephants just go nuts and destroy all of the huts and everything else and just trash the place.
And stomp the fuck out of maybe a third of the people who are on this journey.
Yeah.
So, cut to...
I mean, there's zero provocation. Like, they're just walking in like,
oh, no, they're just like, hello. Hey, where's everybody? And then just elephants show up, and you're like, oh, the elephants have come to greet us. And it's like, oh, no, they have not.
They're back, and they want revenge.
They're pissed.
We know what you did last time. We never forget.
So there's some shots of them pulling out guns and shooting at elephants on, like, rear projection screens.
Yeah, there's one that looks like a dude is just straight up, like, executing an elephant.
Yeah. Well, he does, because that's the moment the other elephants are like, okay, no.
Oh, man, these guys mean business.
We've shown you what we're all about. We'll see you later. At which point, they just cut to the survivors having dinner.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and this is where we learn the tragic backstory of Johnny.
This dinner starts, and, like, they've just, like, four or five people have gotten executed by elephants, and then they straight up, like, gangland style executed that elephant, and then they cut to, like, they're roasting meat on a fire. It's like, is that elephant or human?
Yeah, like, what are you eating?
Yes.
Which of the people or the elephant? Yeah, but they see Johnny.
Yes, it is.
But they see Johnny sitting over by himself, mm-hmm. and like, oh,
he doesn't like elephant or human.
No, yeah. he's just smoking. And they're like, let's go talk to him and see what's up with him. And they're kind of just joshing him around. They're just, you know, like, hey, someone broke your heart. Is that why you came with us, huh?
He's like, well, actually, yes.
Yeah. Let me tell you my story. And it's like, I had this girl and we ran on the beach and we did things.
Love theme from Peking Man montage of
them just dating and doing such things. And he's like, one day I went to our apartment with flowers to give them to my sweetheart.
But I heard voices.
I hear voices.
Yeah. The voices he heard was
sex voices.
Yeah. Was her just boning.
Mm-hmm. And she was
with another dude.
Another dude.
And the dude says, well, it started out as a joke.
Yeah. Okay. First of all, it's his brother.
Yeah. They don't. We
that
find
never
that out
starts
later.
Out as just a joke.
Yeah. We find that
y'all
out.
Start out trying to fuck.
Yes.
Yeah. We find out way later that it's his brother.
They may have mentioned it because they do mention something about him being a TV producer. Mm-hmm. Maybe they threw out the word brother, but it was like, I don't know.
Yeah.
But
either way, he walks in and they're just like, oh, Johnny.
Yeah.
And the brother's being like, hey, man, it started out as a joke. I don't know how we got here.
He takes it further than the it's not what it looks like. I've never heard the it started as a joke.
Yeah.
Like, how do you start that as a joke?
How do you joke fuck?
Knock, knock, who's there? My dick.
Yeah. Well, put it in me. Yeah. There's the punchline. Yeah. Oh, this is fantastic.
You know what would be hilarious? if we fucked. Wouldn't that be a humdinger?
Yeah, I mean, I've heard of a chuckle fuck, but...
Yeah.
My God.
Yeah, it's...
But yeah, Johnny's like, I don't even want her now.
And they're just like, Johnny, no, you don't understand. And it's like... The like, fuck does there, he not understand?
What is there to misunderstand?
Joke.
Yeah. Just a joke, bro. Yeah.
I really want to go back and watch that scene with subtitles and see if that's the same dialogue, because that to me is the most absurd I've been caught thing I've ever heard anyone say. Like, how?
Yeah.
Like, I wanted that moment to then flash back to the moment where the joke started to flesh that part out.
Flashback within a flashback?
Yes. But no, he runs away, and then that's basically...
Yeah, and all the other guy's like, man, that sucks.
Yeah. So, we're going to find this thing, right? Mm-hmm. And he's like, I don't know, whatever. So
the next day, they set out.
Danger number two.
Oh, my God.
Confronts them.
Like...
Well, they're just like walking along, and like... Behind, like, they're just walking like in kind of like a single file line off to the side. Isn't there just a tiger just kind of chilling?
Yeah, yeah.
And they're like, oh, look. Hey, look, there's a tiger. And the tiger's like, hey, people.
And holy shit, there's a stuntman just wrestling with this tiger.
It's a real fucking tiger.
And we've all seen Roar. And we're like, oh, shit, this guy's getting scalped.
On top of that, though, like, they see the tiger and the entire party goes, oh, shit, tiger, scatter. And like three of them go whoop, and like straight into quicksand. And it's like it's the quickest of sand because they're
not slow sand, damn it.
They are over their heads like buried.
They're like, nothing but hat in like 1.4 seconds. It's like, Billy. Yeah. Oh, it's just your hat now. Yeah. I
remember you by this hat.
Yeah. But yeah, they cut from that to like just this guy wrestling around with this tiger, and you're like, holy shit, this is happening.
Mm-hmm.
To which, when they cut to close-ups, it's a guy kind of throwing around the most drugged tiger you've ever seen. But when they're in a wider shot, it's full on some guy wrestling a tiger.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
At which point, you just see like this comical leg, and a tiger something goes rip. And that leg is gone.
I thought it was a mosquito.
No, it's no.
Oh.
But yeah, so this guy is just like, my leg. And so they've shot at, chased the tigers away.
Yeah.
And the leader of this exposition, who's Captain Unscrupulous, whoever he is, goes over to the guy who's just screaming in pain. Like, his leg is gone. Of course, he's freaking out. And he's just like, oh, well, you have to shoot horses.
Yeah,
so.
He fucking sends that dude to the glue factory.
Mm-hmm.
He's just like,
we're
done here.
And Johnny's like, what the, what are you doing?
He's like, you don't put him down. He's a human.
Yeah. And he's like, he was suffering. We can't have that. And I'm like,
we don't want to waste the medicine on him.
And I'm at, like, at this point, like, all the dudes should just leave. Like, this is like, no way. This day two sucks. Day one was bad enough. My brother got gored by an elephant. So yeah, they soldier on and they start scaling some cliffs.
Yeah, and just random, like one of his other buddies,
mm-hmm.
because it's basically there's three, you know, there's Johnny, there's I guess the other kind of expedition guy, and then the leader guy.
Yes.
And then everyone else is kind of like, I guess the Eastern Indian dudes.
Yes.
But the other guide guy, just his little grappling hook comes out of the cliffside, mm-hmm. and then just the him and the group of guys behind him. Ah,
and three dummies go off this fake cliff, and you're just like, what? This is the worst. Turn around and go home now.
Well, they basically go up to the top of the cliff, and the leader guy's like, all right, this is fucked. We're done. Like, I'm leaving.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, yeah. Like, as Johnny's sleeping, they all just mm-hmm. bolt.
Yes.
So he wakes up, and he's alone.
Yeah. And it's so weird. There's that 1 3-second shot of a miniature tent that they've built for no fucking reason.
Mm-hmm.
Because they show this shot, and you're like, what, is a foot going to come in and stomp this? No, it just cuts to the regular tent again, and he wakes up the next day, and it's just like...
Why was that a miniature shot?
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's weird.
Yeah. And we will note something they saw the day before.
Oh, right.
Before hitting the cliff, like, after getting up the cliffside.
Yeah.
Is they see a blonde person off in the distance mm-hmm. swinging in the vines.
Yep.
And then they're gone.
And they're like...
And none of them are like... You see this shit?
Yeah. They're like
none of it. They're just like,
what was that?
Huh. Well, keep going. It was probably nothing. Mm-hmm. It's not a giant Peking man that we've come looking for, so doesn't matter.
Right. And it could kill us, because everything else we found has.
Mm-hmm.
But yeah, so he's basically the only one left.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. And like kind of walks outside and is like, where'd everybody go? And mm-hmm. you basically hear, you know, noises rustling in the jungle, and mm-hmm. out pops Mighty Peking Man, basically. And it's just like, hey.
Yep.
And guy's like, come here, I want to kill you.
Yeah. He's like, no. He doesn't quite know what to do, but then...
Doesn't he kind of like hide in some sort of like thicket?
Yeah, he's hiding behind trees and stuff, and mm-hmm. Mighty Peking Man is just ripping the trees out of the ground.
Mm-hmm.
And eventually just kind of like smacks him and knocks him upside the head, right?
Mm-hmm. I think he throws something at him, because Mighty Peking Man likes to throw things.
Yeah, well, yeah.
Because it's... We didn't mention it in the earlier scene when the villagers, when he's just like, hey, fuck all y'all villagers. The villagers actually have catapults.
Yeah.
And they're launching decent-sized rocks at it. And Mighty Peking Man's like, let me try mine.
wait, guys. Yeah. Let me, can I have a turn?
That's not a rock.
Yeah. But yeah, he picks up a rock. Giant boulder and just hucks it at a couple of villagers. Yeah. But anyway, so he throws something, I think, and hits Johnny in the head and gets knocked out. And I think he's going in for the final kill. And that's when... The blonde lady shows up and is like...
Samantha.
Well, yes, we don't know that yet, but yes, blonde lady from the trees mm-hmm. shows up and is like, speaking
she's
gibberish.
She knells at...
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Chicopee, mm-hmm. Mighty Peking Man.
Yeah. So, yeah.
And talks Mighty Peking Man down. It's like, no. And it doesn't say don't kill, but it, you know, waves him off and gets him to carry Johnny back to her cave.
Right. Mm-hmm. She has a one-bedroom apartment in the side of this mountain.
Mm-hmm.
Very exclusive.
Yeah. And, Peking Man plops Johnny in there, to which he eventually kind of wakes up and is just, like, looking around. It's like, well, someone lives here. There's fruit and a compact. And what the hell is this? And then she swings in.
Yep.
Like, hey.
And he's like, damn, girl, you got your left titty out.
Uh-huh. Yeah, this lady, so this is a Swiss actress who is super blonde and super almost nude.
Incredibly blonde.
Yeah, like hardcore blonde, like the blonde, like...
Swedish bikini team blonde.
Yes. Yeah. Tall, statuesque
mm-hmm.
lady, barely wearing anything.
Always with her left titty out.
Yeah.
Pretty much.
Well,
whatever they had.
To be fair, for like the first 20 minutes of this movie, I was like, what kind of magic glue have they put on her? Because like, she's wearing like one of those sort of bikini tops that only has one strap that goes over the shoulder.
Mm-hmm.
So like the one sort of freewheeling titty over there is just always like threatening to pop out.
I love that Bob Dylan album.
Yeah.
Never can trust a stray titty.
Well, I'm just saying, like, for like the first 20 minutes, it is just... on the edge of popping out all the
time. It's on the edge of glory.
Yeah, and then, like, finally it happens, and then it just can't stay, stay contained after that.
Mm-hmm. It won't be held down anymore. It's taste of freedom, and it never wants to go back.
Needs to breathe. Yeah.
But anyway, she's wearing her little loincloth outfit, mm-hmm. and he starts trying to communicate with her, and she's basically just doesn't have any words. And he says, well, who's your mama and your papa? And she goes, oh, mama,
yeah, papa, come with me.
And takes him to a crashed plane.
Yes.
And suddenly has flashbacks to
childhood. It's a special cameo by Uncle Owen and Aunt Beru.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah, because we like we didn't need
this. Same year as Star Wars. It was a nice cross promotion.
Yeah, we didn't need the flashback because like he's like, oh, well, let me check out the cockpit. Oh, two corpses burned to a crisp. Well, yeah. This is bad. Yeah.
Oh, and here's a picture of your parents, which he shows her, and then that's when she's like, ah!
Right, yeah. And he finds, like, a diary. It's like, oh, your name's Samantha.
So, it's a little weird here, because the flashback that they show where the plane is crashing, she looks old enough that she should comprehend just a touch more English than she does.
Yeah, yes. She's 7, 8, 9.
Not that old, but she's old enough that, like, she would have picked up more than Mama and Papa.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Maybe she forgot it all, living in the jungle with Titty hanging out for so long.
Yeah.
Yeah, for 15 years or so.
Yes. I don't know.
When you have nothing to talk to but a monkey. It's... Yeah.
Yeah.
But
yeah, it shows the plane crashes, parents toss her out the plane, and then burn up inside the plane. Mm-hmm. And Mighty Peking Man finds the child, picks her up, and... Yeah,
gives her some food and says, I will take you to this spacious one-bedroom apartment.
Yep.
Mm-hmm.
And that's her origin story.
Mm-hmm.
It is.
Yeah, so I guess there's some Tarzan tossed in here, too, just in case.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Sure. Yeah, but otherwise, then it's just them being friends, and they go out into the jungle, and apparently the tiger is her pet.
Oh, God.
As is a jaguar and other things, and this is when you get, like, the super doped up felines.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, they have drugged the hell out of, like, these jaguars and, you know... whatever cougars, whatever they are, and she's just going over and hugging on them, and they are just heavy breathing, just eyes like duh. But eventually she's like, food, and scoots up this tree like, I don't know,
like people, like a jungle woman,
like yes. People that scoot up trees,
yes, and you know, starts throwing fruit at Johnny. To which
they look like pomegranates or something.
Yeah, and she comes back down, and they're both eating the fruit, and he's just like, "Oh God, this is terrible." And she laughs at him and just continues eating. And then right next to her is a cobra,
mm-hmm.
which is just like, "I'm hungry too," and goes and bites the fuck out of her inner thigh.
Yeah,
just at the opposite inner thigh too. Like it had to go over the thigh where it was to get over to the fleshy middle. so, and then it's just. Oh, God, I'm dying. So
it's the thigh of the tiger.
Yeah, and he jumps on her and sucks the poison out.
Yes.
Which doesn't work. Don't ever do that.
No. But he's got a mouthful of fake blood.
Well, we learned in Snakes on a Plane, you have to coat your mouth in olive oil first.
Yes.
Then you can suck the poison
out. However,
he didn't have any of that.
She tosses the snake away, and one of the tigers or whatever just rips this fucking thing to shreds.
Yeah. I think they've tossed it at an already dead snake, but man, this thing is just like, fuck yes. It's like,
either way, the ASPCA is like, whoa.
Yeah.
Whoa, guys.
Yeah.
Wait, we think some animals were harmed in the making of this movie.
Well, don't worry. There's nothing at the end of this movie stating otherwise.
No, there's nothing at the end of this movie.
It's like the end, get the fuck out.
Yeah. But yeah, so like, he's like trying to suck out the poison, and she's just, and cutting to the tiger mauling the snake.
Mm-hmm.
And then he just scoops her up and takes her back home.
Well, yeah, an elephant shows up and is like, I heard your distress call.
Elephant taxi shows up and immediately like kneels down and he throws her on there. And then he's like, go forward, move. And it does. And it takes him right back to the apartment.
Yeah.
So, we don't really understand how he gets her back up.
Yeah, because the only way to and from is on a rope swing. So how he got her.
Vine.
Yeah.
Yeah. Who knows?
But
either way.
It's a 6 second ride.
Yeah. But it's a montage of time passing and her not doing well and him kind of pacing around not knowing what to do.
Well, but she's in there moaning away.
Yes.
Like moaning as if she's close.
Mm-hmm.
And you just need to
dying?
Stick. No.
No.
You just need to stick to that one spot and don't worry.
Yeah.
And Peking Man hears it and is like,
that's my jam.
Yeah.
Yeah.
He's like, I'm going to make it rain with leaves.
Yes.
In front of the doorway.
Yeah. And Johnny's just like, okay, yeah, this all makes perfect sense. Mm-hmm. I'll just take these leaves and mortar and pestle them up and make a sauce. And
well, he kind of knife and coconuts them, but yeah.
Yeah. But yeah. And then rubs the whatever it is on the wound,
mm-hmm.
which they either bruised her or did a really good job with the makeup there. Yeah. But yeah, rubs that, and then that's when he does the pacing around, waiting, and then she just kind of wakes up and is like, "All right."
Yeah, she's like, "Oh,"
and he's like, "You're alive."
Mm-hmm. And she starts to walk towards him, and there's a step down. They have like a a sunken living room, and she stumbles because she's been out of it for a while, and he catches her. He has come in all sweaty and shirtless,
mm-hmm.
and they, she falls onto him, and they start embracing, and it's just like, "Oh, okay, let's mm-hmm. have the sex now."
Mm-hmm. This makes sense.
Yes, totally.
Yeah.
So.
Yeah. So they lay down on the bed, and then we get to the another love theme from Peking Man.
Yeah.
Montage.
What happens here? They're starting the lovemaking, and then cut to them slow-mo running through the jungle.
Mm-hmm.
Cut to her with one of the cougar tiger things on her shoulders, spinning around.
Just, it's so great.
Just like she's giving this thing the torture rack. Spinning around. And then they put
high
it down.
Ass leopard.
Yeah, but they put it down, and they're just holding on to it and just spinning, the hills are alive, and the thing is eventually kind of crawling away out of the scene, and they keep fucking with it.
Yeah.
Like, "Hey, buddy cougar," it's like, "Leave the fucking thing alone." Yeah. It doesn't want to be there.
Haven't you seen Roar? It's a bad idea.
They had not.
But no. Eventually, through all this, it cuts back to them in still going at it,
mm-hmm.
and you see Mighty Peking Man's face come down right in the doorway and just stare, and you're like, "Oh, okay."
He likes to watch. A Mighty Peking Tom.
Yeah, when he becomes truly Mighty Peking Man.
Yes. And
then he just kind of walks off like,
Well, he kind of has a fit. He just starts pulling trees out of the ground and just stomping. He's not super freaking out, but he's just like, "God damn it, I thought I had a shot." But
just as a point of reference, why do giant ape-like creatures desire a very tiny human-sized person?
That's all they got.
Because they're soft and they smell pretty.
Yeah. Same reason we all do.
I'm not trying to modernify these ideas of these giant monster movies or whatever, but mm-hmm. Is there some kind of
there might be there? Some racism there.
Well, yeah. I don't know about is it racism or is it
I think it's more they just
male dominance and
they're the guy in the friend zone. They can never have her. No, hear me out.
Yeah, big old hairy neckbeard motherfucker. Yeah,
they can never have her, but they don't want anyone else to have her either. And they don't understand why they can never have her.
Physics?
All these chads taking my jungle girl. Mm.
But that's my theory on it is...
Yeah, I just...
All these giant apes have just been friend-zoned, and they refuse to accept it.
Yeah.
And they're going to get pouty.
They're all in the same web forum.
And post on Reddit.
So they all have the same opinion.
Yeah. But so he storms off to post on Reddit.
Yeah.
And she notices this and goes outside. Mm-hmm. And he's like, "Oh, wait, come back."
And she kind of snuggles his hand.
Mm-hmm.
Like, "Oh, you'll always be my special little guy."
Mm-hmm.
And apparently that's good enough for him.
Yeah. "I can always call you and complain about my current boyfriend."
Yeah. You'll listen, right?
Yeah.
So there's a really fast series of events where Johnny is basically like, "Hey, let's take him back to Hong Kong. I think people really get a kick out of him."
Mm-hmm.
And then it's just like, "Okay, Peking Man, scoop us up in your hand and walk. Let's go to Hong Kong. The city."
Because there was some scene, I can't remember which one exactly it was, but it faded to someone swimming in a swimming pool.
Oh, right. It was the guy who ran away.
Yeah, the guy who ran it. But the music never stopped mm-hmm. from whatever scene it was before that. And we're like, "Wait, what the fuck is going on?" Right. And it's basically the guy from the beginning who abandoned Johnny.
Yeah.
And is like, "Oh, man, well, we never found Peking Man. And
obviously doesn't exist.
Yeah, it can't be out there. We searched every inch of that island. And mm-hmm. Johnny, he'll never find his way back. He's got to be dead because he's not a jungle man."
Right.
No.
And then it cuts to him, Peking Man, carrying them, showing up at whatever, giant building this is. Where everyone immediately is running out screaming. Because... what else would you do? and they're all freaking out, and she tells Peking Man to lay down. She kind of dabs at him and gives the universal symbol of lay down.
I just love that when they're riding in his palm and they have the shot of him just like towering over these buildings and stuff, and everyone is screaming, running, and Johnny's just looking at it like, this is going well.
Yeah.
Yeah.
They're going to love this.
Meanwhile, everyone in the city is like, oh my God.
Yeah. Yeah. So he lays down. They get out and, you know, go into the crowd. It's like, no, it's chill. Let's go find the guy. They go find the guy and bring him back. And the guy's stoked. He's just like, sweet. We're going to take this guy to Hong Kong and it's going to be awesome.
Yeah. And I really dislike that there's never a point where Johnny's like, yeah, remember me, who you left in the fucking jungle, you piece of shit?
Never comes up.
He's like, no. Hey, all right, cool.
Yeah, let's go.
Let's bring him to Hong Kong. Let's do this.
We're going to make some money.
Yeah.
And then cut to them on the freighter.
Oh, my God.
Which they cut to Peking Man, who is just chained. Like, I've never... They are somehow convincing him... They're convincing this giant ape to go along with whatever's happening the whole time. Like, okay, now, buddy, sit on the boat. Okay, now we're going to put this chain around your neck. Now we're going to chain your arms. Now we're going to chain your feet.
I'm sure it was budget constraints, but I'm sure there should have been a scene where she, you know, they talked her into talking him into doing that.
Right.
Yeah.
But
the
size difference and all that, they were barely holding it together as it was in the movie.
Right.
I'm sure they were just like, you'll understand that she talked him into doing that.
And this thing looks like a giant teddy bear sitting on a toy boat. It is.
I kind of want, the Mighty Peking Man like boat playset.
Yeah.
Where just this, like, you know, like one of those little plastic boats you had in the bathtub with with a gorilla thing sitting on it.
But she's immediately like, why is he in chains? This is terrible. And they're like,
again, she probably should have seen him going into the chains.
But they're just like, look, he's got to be in chains. If he gets loose, he'll rock the boat and don't rock the boat. So.
Rock the boat?
Don't rock the boat.
Rock the boat.
Don't tip the boat over.
So, yeah. And she's just like, well, okay. And retires to her cabin with Johnny. And Johnny's like, okay, now listen. You can't go around wearing those animal skins anymore. Here.
Here's a different animal skin. Yes.
Put on this snake skin.
You can't wear deer skin. You have to wear snake skin because it's the city.
Put on this weird whore outfit that I bought you, which is the shortest skirt ever, and just like a vest, and that's it. Just put it on. And she starts to put it on, and then like the evil boss comes into the room, and there's this odd, like, she's just standing there, and everyone's like, yep, she's nude. Eventually, Johnny just kind of throws a shirt on her and pushes her into the dressing room. Like, just go in there and get ready.
Again, this is like a dumb nitpick, but she's abandoned. She grows up by herself, develops some sort of sense of modesty where she puts clothes on. And then this guy walks in, sees her naked, and she's just like, yeah, what? So
I think it's just clothing from a practical standpoint. She's got to keep them.
Yeah, like I was saying,
wrangled mostly.
She runs so much, they'd be hitting her in the face,
and then she's got to protect her hoo-ha. So that's why she wears bottoms.
We did see her run. That what she was wearing was not helping that much. Practical standpoint is that they didn't want this.
I'm not actually making these excuses for the record.
The practical standpoint is they didn't want this actress walking around naked the entire movie.
Correct.
You know,
so yes.
I'm just saying it's.
They might have. Someone said they couldn't sell it if they did that, so. They just snuck in a lot of nudity along the way.
Sure.
But yeah, so Johnny and Boss Man have a discussion. Johnny's kind of like, I don't know about this. I got him all the way onto the boat for you, but now I have second thoughts. And the guy's like, look, contract or something, and you're going to make money, so shut the fuck up. And Johnny's like, yeah, you make a good point. So
this is when they pop champagne. Like, there's another scene that's like, oh, she's like, she comes out because she goes into like the bathroom, I guess it was, to finish changing into this weird leather whore outfit that they gave her.
Right.
And
she
comes out and it's just like, number one, where'd you go? And number two, this thing sucks.
Yeah.
And so she just like rips it off, throws it out the window and plops down on the bed. Again, naked, not that, you know, for our viewing pleasure.
No.
But, and then like cut to like everyone's in like the mess hall of this ship just popping champagne. It's like, huh, symbolism.
Yep.
But
And they're like, we're going to make a lot of money. And then guy comes in, like, weather report for you, Captain.
Yeah. There's a typhoon.
Yeah. Coming straight for us.
Yeah. And he's like, well, we need to stop in Singapore or wherever and just wait it out because it's going to get bad out here. Mm-hmm. And he's like, I'm going to lose money on these days if you don't take this boat through that storm.
You go straight to Hong Kong.
Yeah.
Is that, and he's like, and "Well, like, you vouch for like the damage when the typhoon fucks us up?" And the guy's like, "Yes, I will. It's going to be A-OK." And then just cut to a bathtub with the toy boat and the guy sitting on it, and it's just rocking around like it looks bad.
It eventually runs into a rock. They have to let him let his arm loose so he can push them off from the rock.
Yes, it's a very long, drawn out sequence where Johnny and Samantha run out and are just getting doused with water, and eventually they get one hand unchained and he pushes the rock and they travel on to Hong Kong.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Hooray, he is a hero.
Yep. He is. So they treat him
like shit.
Put him in a stadium.
They put him in a stadium.
And lock him to cranes and several trucks full of, like, you know, those huge quarry-sized dump trucks? Mm-hmm. Well, they have, like, five of those, and they're filled with rocks
and rubble.
And they got chains on them, and they're pulling him, and he's pulling them.
Yeah.
And everybody's cheering and throwing fruit.
This is just, because, like, Johnny and the girl go to visit the brother.
Mm-hmm. Which he's now totally cool with. He just walks in and is like, "Hey, bro, long time no see.
Yeah, how you
last
been?
Time I saw you, oh, you were in my fiance."
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And I was real sad. Mm-hmm. And it led me to find her and a giant monkey in the woods.
Yes. This is how far you pushed me, brother.
Mm-hmm. So the ex-girlfriend...
And he's also like, "And yo, check out my new girl, Samantha."
Yeah.
Here. Right. But like, I again, just like, there are lots of dumb things in this movie, obviously. Uh-huh. But like, when he's like, along the way, Samantha has now picked up some more English along the way, and he's just like, "Would you like to go to a TV studio?"
Yeah, and she's like, "Yes, I would."
Sure. Yeah. That means fuck all to me.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, remember Jungle Lady?
Yeah.
Yep. Where they are making the world's most boring music video.
It is the worst. It is literally the worst.
They're putting on 70s disco Wing.
Yeah.
Essentially, because this lady is just, like, they've built this weird stage with, like, ramps and ladders and all this stuff, but she's just standing in the center of it, just warbling out this disco tune.
Yeah.
Yep.
And the reason the ex-girlfriend wanted to have joke sex with the brother was because the brother is a TV producer and she wanted to work in television. So she is now working in television and happens to be there at the studio. So she sends a note to Johnny, who's sitting with Samantha in the studio watching this terrible song performance happen. And so he goes to see her in her dressing room. I don't have half a clue about what she's rambling about during the scene, but it's just basically like, "I made a mistake. I didn't want to have sex with him. It was a joke. Mm-hmm. It happened. Get over it, you son of a bitch."
Yeah. Why did you make me so sad by leaving?
You ran away.
I mean, this is a dub, but I mean, it sounds like nobody bothered to get the lady dubbing her anywhere close to the mic.
Yeah, she's constantly like, "I'm back here.
And also, I'm talking about things, and you forgive me."
Yeah, and you're watching this, and you're like, "Oh, fuck, they're going to make out, and for some reason, that's when the girl is going to walk into the dressing room, even though she should have no concept of jealousy whatsoever. None."
Nope.
And they hug, and then the girlfriend's like, "Time to make out with Johnny again," and boom, door opens.
Of course. But she has a concept of jealousy, because Mighty Peking Man has taught her this.
But when? It wasn't until Johnny showed up.
He stormed off after Johnny.
I guess.
Yeah.
But, she runs off, and that's kind of her last main interaction with the rest of the crew, because pretty much for the rest of the movie, she's running around on her own.
Yeah.
The entire time.
Yeah, because he goes running out after her, like, "Wait, stop," and she uses her jungle stealth skills to hide behind a car. And he just runs right by her. And basically, she's just wandering around in this, like, you know, loincloth and bikini thing. And
nobody cares.
Nobody cares. Nobody's even,
nobody
like,
in
even
Hong
look,
Kong cares.
Like, no. Number one, she's about 6 foot tall. She's giant. She's blonde haired, blue eyes.
Super nude.
Wearing a leather bikini thing.
Yep.
In a land full of shortish, dark-haired people, and no one cares.
No. And she wanders up to a couple who are getting into their car, and she's like, "Peking
Man.
Take
me to Wuta."
Yeah. And they're like, "Oh, Peking Man? Yeah, sure, get in." Like, what the fuck?
Yeah.
I mean, if a giant blonde titty hanging out
it
Amazon 70s, comes up to your...
Yeah.
Comes up to your car and says, "Take me to the Peking Man."
That's true. The 70s were a very chill time.
Two rules for life, Chuck. You know, half-naked, you know, jungle lady... And or if someone asks you a god, if you're a god,
you say yes.
You say yes to both.
Gotcha. That's rules to live by.
Yeah. We'll add more as we come to them.
Okay, but, yeah. Good. Write them down.
But yeah, but we didn't mention when they were doing the stadium show with the big trucks and everything.
Mm-hmm.
Peking Man isn't having any of it, and everyone in the crowd throws fruit and vegetables at him.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And it's like, yeah, fuck you, giant 50-foot tall ape.
Yeah, I don't know why they brought fruit and vegetables with them to a show.
That's what you do, man.
I guess.
But so he's in the cage, like...
All right, that's another dick move. They built a cage where he has to remain standing up.
Yeah.
And like, he's chained to it.
And he's chained, like, can't move his arms. Like, so if his nose is itching, it's like, yeah, well.
Yeah, and all the guys at the bottom of the cage have these big sticks, and they're just like, hey, you're not so tough, are you, asshole? Yeah. And they're, like, poking his feet. They're like, we're going to make you do what we want you to do.
Yeah, dance, motherfucker.
Yeah.
So they're just...
And she comes in, she's like, what are you... Like, you need to stop. And that's, you know, and this gets Mighty Peking Man fired up, mm-hmm. and they're all like, oh, shit, and run out.
Yeah, they run
out. And that's when Shady promoter guy...
Mm-hmm.
grabs her. He's like, okay, come with me. We gotta take care of some stuff.
Yeah, let's go talk about your outfit.
Mm-hmm.
And the movie gets unfortunate.
Yeah, which leads to him pouring a couple bottles of alcohol or a couple glasses and
hands it to her, and she's just like, has no clue what to do. And he's like, here, let me help you. Lean back and let me pour this all over your face.
Yeah.
It goes way downhill from there.
Yeah, it devolves into what you think it's going to devolve into.
Which we were hoping it wouldn't.
Yeah.
But
however, as she's fighting back, she pulls open the blinds.
Yes. Because Peking Man.
And
likes
dude
to
has
watch.
A great view of Peking Man from his apartment.
He does.
Peking Man has a sense.
Yeah.
Peking Man has a great view of this dude's apartment from where he lives.
Yeah. And
he is not happy.
No.
This is when he bends the bars and is like, fuck all y'all.
Yep.
And
it's on.
Yeah. And comes stomping over and starts just smashing the building.
Mm-hmm.
She escapes somehow. I didn't even really follow it. I think it's just like in the chaos. She's like, oh shit.
Because he
looks out the window. He's like, oh great, Peking Man's loose.
Yeah. Because he reaches in and grabs the dude.
Yeah. Well, he picks up the phone.
Oh, no, that's right. That's right. The dude runs away.
Oh, yeah.
I thought he dragged her to the next thing.
Oh, yeah. He catches her outside.
Yeah,
that's right.
Get in the car. Yep, and it throws her in the car while Peking Man's just like, fuck this building. Mm-hmm. Smash, smash.
Yeah, that's right. Because he's driving his Porsche around really fast while Peking Man is chasing them. And they stop because there's like a gate. And he gets out to lift the gate. And that's when she's like, oh, I can get away now. And she runs away.
But like while they were driving, Peking Man is smashing up the freeway.
Oh, everything.
Trying to just put a stop to wherever they may be or may be going.
Hey, he stops for a couple random rampages too. Like just, hey, people in there like having dinner?
They
punch. Yeah.
They went Toho and built a lot of miniature sets for this guy. I mean, in the beginning, I got to say, like the set they built for the little jungle that gets like the fissure splits open and he just destroys everything is pretty damn sweet. And this is like a pretty damn good giant city.
Yes.
There's just ripping apart.
There's detail to it. It's not just a bunch of plaster and cardboard. I mean, but yeah, like there's one point where he just punches into a building and grabs a couple people and just throws them to the ground from his height.
Yeah.
He's full on rampage now. It's doesn't matter.
He's like, fuck this city.
Yeah.
Suck my mighty Peking dick.
Yes.
Fuck all y'all.
I'm going to fuck the city to death.
Yes. Pretty much.
It is time. Because, yeah, that's basically the rest of this movie is him wandering around smashing the fuck out of everything.
Eventually...
The sleazy promoter guy gets her to another apartment. Mm-hmm. Not his, because he throws open the door to that bedroom, and there's another couple in there engaging in coitus.
Mm-hmm.
And so this kind of confuses sleazy promoter guy. And this gives Peking Man enough time to reach in and grab him.
Mm-hmm.
And then he yanks him out. And then he's kind of squishing him a little bit and just fucking slam dunks him. Just throws him down.
And then stomps on him.
Mm-hmm.
Good.
And then just starts stomping anybody else in his way. Like, anyone who trips trying to get away, fuck you. You're getting stomped. So I guess at some point Johnny has gotten wind of this because everyone has kind of come outside. The weird thing is that wherever the next scene starts, everyone in the scene is just kind of going about their business.
Mm-hmm.
Like, somehow word is not traveling that there's a giant monkey going around.
You would think.
Fucking up the city. Because every new location they go to is just people milling about, having dinner, engaging in social activities, just, you know. And then all of a sudden, oh my God, the buildings are exploding.
Yeah.
So, this just begins military press.
Yeah.
Because we're introduced to British man.
Mm-hmm. Who's running the military, well, somehow.
They would be.
Yes.
Yeah, at that point, yes.
Yes. But, yeah, it's just British man in charge of military gets on the radio and is like, look, everyone get out there now. We're going to kill this thing. You hear me? We're going to kill it. We are going to kill it. Us. We are the ones.
Yeah.
Kill Peking man. Ready? Go.
Yeah, and they send out some tanks that shoot at him, and he's like, fuck your tanks. Mm-hmm. Smashes those. And then eventually it's just the helicopters keep shooting at him. And he gets, I mean, it's there's a lot of him just smashing everything.
Yeah.
Well, it's not King Kong. It's Mighty Peking Man. They didn't use planes. They used helicopters.
Right.
Of course.
Totally different.
But eventually he climbs up to the top of a building that is conveniently like a Lego and just has holes all throughout the side of it.
Easy so footholds.
Yeah, it's like the pegboard building, and he's just able to climb up to the top.
Which apparently is a real building because they show several shots of this building. So it's like, well, that's a logical choice to use.
Yeah, they probably looked at it and said, I would climb that if I was a giant Mighty Peking Man.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah.
So
he gets up to the top, and they're like, all right, we got him trapped. And that's when Johnny, he's met up with Samantha, and been like, all right, come with me. And knows who the general is somehow. He knows who's in charge, talks to him, and is like, listen.
Well, the funny thing
is, he'll listen to her.
Before he catches up to her, they put out an APB for her.
That's right.
Where it's just like, hey, look, it's a mostly nude giant blonde lady. And at one point, like, a mass group of people are all like, that's her. And they just start chasing her down the streets of Hong Kong, to which she, like, climbs up a light
shimmies
pole.
Shimmies up a light pole and then leaps onto a hill. And
yeah. But then for the rest of the time, she's running around and no one's paying her any mind whatsoever. So no one's paying her any mind that she's there normally. Mm-hmm. But especially now that an All Points Bulletin has gone out for her, no one is remotely giving shit. But Johnny kind of just bumps into her and is like, come on, we have to go save Mighty Peking Man.
Yeah.
Well, so that's wasn't the mob chasing her? Like, there was a mob of people.
Yeah,
A mob that saw her climb up a light pole.
Yeah, like, right away, she's found. But, like, after she escapes that part, then no one else sees her again until Johnny finds her.
Yeah, they just run right straight to the head guy of the military. Yeah.
They're like, hey.
Yeah, and they're basically like, he'll
listen to
her. We don't know why. We don't know how to explain it, but he'll listen to her.
Mm-hmm.
And he's like, all right. And Johnny's like, do you promise you won't attack him?
Yeah.
Like, we'll let her talk him down, and we can get him back into the jungle or wherever.
Because what the military has planned is they have pumped the water reserve in the building with gasoline. So all the tanks inside the building are now filled with gasoline.
Mm-hmm.
And they're going to set charges on those and just... They don't give a fuck about this building. They're like, fuck that building. We're going to blow everything up and him with it.
Yeah.
So Johnny's like, you have to give us your word.
Yeah.
As a British man, an honorable British man, that you will not blow up this building until we have a chance to go up there and deal with this. Mm-hmm. And he's like, you have my word. I'm honorable British man. So they go up there.
Yeah. And they make it up there, and she's able to talk to him, and
she calms him down.
Yeah.
And everything's cool.
Yeah, she's like, let's go. We're going to go back to the jungle.
Yep. We're gonna climb down. Everything's going to be cool. And British guy's like, okay, he's calm.
Yeah.
Murder him.
Now's our chance.
Light his candle.
Light him up.
Yeah. So.
They end up shooting her.
Yeah.
But not killing her.
No.
Johnny gets up there. He's like, fuck, man.
Yeah.
And gets, and she basically, like, well, he's on the lower level, and suddenly soldiers are there, and they're planting bombs everywhere. Yeah. And he's like, what the fuck are you doing?
Yeah.
He gave me his word. You need to stop. And they're like, listen.
You're a naive idiot.
Yeah.
Get out of our way.
You didn't get that. You didn't get a contract, did you?
Yeah. No.
Nope.
No.
Yeah, notary didn't even stamp it, did he? Yeah. Nope. All right, then.
So they knock him out. Because he runs
tries
over
to fight like a bunch, but there's like 20 of them there.
Yeah, so they conk him on the back of the head, and he's out. So they set all their charges, and they get out.
Yeah, and he wakes up, and he's like, "Oh my god!" And he yanks the plug out of one of the charges, and then goes and like there's like 20 tanks there, and every one of them has like
two or three
bombs on them. He's like, "Fuck!"
Yeah. So it's just like, get to the roof, and it's like, we gotta go.
Yeah,
we have to get out of here.
Everything is getting shot up.
Yeah. Like, she's been shot 3 or 4 times at this point. Like, she was in his hand at one point and getting shot, and then he puts her down, and she's still getting shot. Because the choppers don't give a fuck what they're shooting at. They're just shooting at anything.
Yeah, it's
she's well. He's like, come on, we gotta go. All
right, we gotta go. They're gonna blow it up. We have to go now.
And she kind of follows him over to the stairs and then pushes him down and then shuts the door and locks it.
Well, she stalls because she tries to hug Muddy Peeking Man's foot or whatever.
Yeah,
and then she throws him down the thing and locks it.
Mm-hmm. And the so Johnny gets back down a little bit. The charges go off.
Yeah.
The top of the building goes up.
Yeah. And Mighty Peeking Man becomes Mighty Burning Man because his back's on fire.
Yep. Surrounded by explosions.
Mm-hmm. I will say, when they set off those tanks, they get some good explosions going on in that little area. I don't know what they blew up exactly, but it looks good.
It looked better than small-scale explosions in a model. Well, like whatever... If that's what it was, they did the exposure right, you know, on the camera to where it didn't look. Because, like, some of the fire stuff from the forest jungle
stuff. I'm going to go with it's probably a model. I'm thinking they didn't set off a giant gasoline explosion.
No, I know, but I mean, you never know. Could have been some abandoned water facility. They were just like, blow this fucker up. Mm-hmm. Anything goes in Hong Kong.
Yeah.
But yeah, so...
They blow it up, and eventually, he somehow drops her into the lower level amidst all the rubble, but still alive, and then falls off the building and smashes another building next door.
The post office.
Yeah, the post office.
And there's a shot of him laying in the post office just going, ah!
Yeah, and a bunch of people that with eBay packages sitting there like, no!
God damn it!
Feedback!
Yes. Yeah. Yeah, and... So Johnny kind of scoops up the girl and walks over to a big gaping hole in the building and just looks out at the carnage. And wham, this Shaw Brothers movie is over.
Yep. Done.
Get out.
Yeah, I guess we don't really know if she's dead. I mean, I guess it's kind of assumed she's dead.
He kind of goes to check her and is not real positive to the reaction he gets and then just still carries her over anyway to the gaping hole.
So
and,
she can look at the wreckage.
Yeah, look.
Peaky Man hath rot.
Look what happened. But yeah, it's just like, get out. This movie is done. The guys need to come clean the theater now. Which is, that's how Shaw Brothers movies end. Yeah. They're just like, this story is over. There is nothing more to see here. Yeah. That's the Mighty Peeking Man.
Sure is.
Which is King Kong.
It is.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah. Soundtrack. All over the place.
It's stock music.
There's so much disco music going on early on, and
some of the incidental music I've heard in other Shaw Brothers movies. So,
yeah,
it's all right. I mean, the music anyway. I mean, some of it fits. It works. It's not like what the hell is this, but yeah, some of the warbly love songs are real warbly.
That disco wing song was particularly bad.
It was unbearable. And there's one point where you think it's over and they thrust it back at you.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then, I mean, it just comes in violently, too. It's just like in the middle, like, it's like, oh, God. I'll go ahead and rate it.
I guess.
I do want to float one little theory here. I think that the head, I mean, it turns out Johnny's not so great of a guy by the end either, because he's kind of willing to go along with all of this.
Yeah.
But the head expedition guy, the guy that's running it, I think he is so unbelievably evil that the jungle animals actually sense that. And I think that's why they just wildly attack. Yeah, because
they can smell evil.
I think so. Like, I mean, I think they're just like, oh, that's like, you know, John Hammond's like evil. Cousin here, like, coming to take this fucker away, like, let's murder him. So that's my theory, is that that's why they were so violent. And really, they were just like trying to send a message, like, you don't want to be here. Like, you need to go home now.
This is not for you.
So that's my theory, is that the animal sensed that, his evilness, because he only got more evil as the movie went on, until he ultimately was let go out of a window, which was fun. So as far as rating goes,
did we even talk about him getting killed? We said we kind of grabbed him, but Peeking Man grabs him, tosses him to the ground, stomps him, which he also does to another guy, which is, it bugs me that he shares the same death with somebody else.
Well,
live stream offline.
I think we're back.
I was gonna say, everyone on the stream is like,
everyone's like, hey, where'd you go?
Don't worry. I caught it. We stopped talking.
Yeah.
You didn't miss anything.
Yeah, we should be back.
I'm waiting
for some confirmation here.
Yeah, I see us back.
Okay.
Hanging I see. I see. Streamies. Chatting around.
Streamies okay. Hang on.
Chatting it up. Don't worry, guys. We stopped. So that's Mighty Peaking Man. We're done now. Eh, just kidding. Do we want? Do you want to clap, Chuck, or anything? Or
no, I'm good.
No, okay.
So yeah, I mean, as far as actual rating goes, I'm. This one's kind of tough. I mean, like, we don't normally like. This is one of those movies. Like, this movie's pretty bad, but it's like bad in an enjoyable way.
Mm-hmm. Good bad movies, you would say. Enjoyable yeah, bad movies.
I mean, like,
those get 1 to 5 Joxes and Robot Jocks.
Right. I just mean like we try to generally find the actual true awesome in something and not like laugh at its. Mm-hmm. Inability to make a movie. Mm-hmm. This one kind of skirts the line because there are cool things happening, but it's a sorely ineptly made movie at the same time. It's strange because
this like, is something that would that almost feels like it's more it belongs more on MST3K than on our show.
Yeah, a little bit. That, and I think maybe that's what I was trying to get at is like there are lots of opportunities to add your own soundtrack to this movie because
mm-hmm.
there is a lot of goofy shit happening and people reacting or not reacting to things that they should be.
Yep.
That it's weird because it almost doesn't feel like one of our movies, despite there being some things that are very much in our wheelhouse.
Okay.
I think I'm going to land at 3 jocks. I know I said all that, but it's like
Are you asking?
No, I'm just like it's weird because it's somewhere between a 2 and a 3 for me. But I think I'm going to err on the side of like there was enough goofy shit, and you know. I appreciate a good freewheeling left hit, you know, from time to time.
Sure.
Not going to lie. Mm. But yeah, it's just straight up King Kong. I mean, it mm-hmm. is straight up like if you were like, I wonder what the, you know, the Asian Roger Corman was make, you know, would make of a King Kong movie. Well, here you go.
Mm-hmm.
Which is strange because like, I mean, other than like Inframan trying to catch on to the Toho Godzilla monsters and other, you know, people growing, like, you know, mm-hmm. stuff like that. Like, why can't I not think of the Ultraman? Like, right. shit like that. I mean, like, right. just trying to cash in on that. Like, Shaw Brothers were not really known for, like, making rip-off movies, really. I mean, that wasn't mm-hmm. really their thing.
Not explicitly. I mean, like, not... They weren't the
not
asylum.
Right. Yeah, not this direct. Yeah, I mean, like, I think
they saw an opportunity.
Sure. And I think maybe that's, my only reservation by saying... I like this more is that it is so much King Kong
mm-hmm.
and
mm-hmm.
with a little Tarzan backstory thrown in for fun,
mm-hmm.
you know, like just swap the genders otherwise, you know, it's kind of, it's weird and it's magnificent. And I think you should see it. I mean, that's why I'm going 3 because I'm boiling it down to like, that's how much I would recommend it mm-hmm. as the 3 jocks recommendation of like, yeah, you should probably see this. And we didn't say it's available on Amazon Prime.
It is.
You know, it was
transfer looks great.
Yeah, it was put out as like one of like the Tarantino Presents mm-hmm. DVD type thing. So it's definitely one of the available ones, not like some of the ones mm-hmm. that are a little harder to find. So
yeah. I can also give it 3 jocks. I thought it was thoroughly entertaining. I didn't think it ever, like when it got to the Carnage stuff, I was like, okay, this is all pretty good. Like there's picks up a car at one point and throws it into a gas station, which explodes. Yeah. And I'm like,
great.
That's pretty damn good. But like some of these giant buildings they built are built to be smashed and they mm-hmm. don't get reduced to rubble. Like they're there, but it's like, well, what else are you going to do with it?
Mm-hmm.
You know, but they're saving it for something. Having now seen a bunch of these Shaw Brothers movies for Bamfcast Extra, I've gotten used to the fact that point A to point B to point C isn't always going to be completely spelled out or clear. So I was kind of ready for how choppy it was already. So that didn't bother me. I just, you know, there's a good time to be had. I think it's kind of, it is, I guess, technically a bad movie because it is goofy, but I think it's kind of endearing in its badness. I think the you know, just cutting, having the sex begin and then cutting to her with a cougar on her shoulders and spinning around in slow motion mm-hmm. is goofy as fuck, but it's my wheelhouse goofy as fuck. It's like,
oh, yeah.
Yeah, absolutely, that's what I want. I mean, I feel bad for the drug tigers and everything, but you know, it's an entertaining movie, and I think it's even more entertaining with a group of friends because it's ready for jokes. It is so ready for jokes.
Yep. I think I liked it better than you guys because I'm going 4 jocks.
Okay.
It's a lot of fun to see this damn ape rampaging through these miniature cities.
Mm-hmm.
You know, and I guess it's just because I don't watch that many of the Toho Godzilla movies and all that sort of stuff. But it's always fun to have that, to have a giant thing going, fuck your city. I'm going to wreck everything.
Right.
You know, and I can't go 5 because so many characters are so unlikable in this movie, and there's really no heroes except for Mighty Peking Man, and it's kind of like you don't even know what his motivations are.
The lady's a hero,
I guess.
Yeah,
it's a little unfortunate that they make her so damsel in distress. You'd think she'd be a little more self reliant, being a jungle lady.
Yes,
but like when the unfortunate bits start to happen, it's like, dude, lady, if you can scale a tree, I'm pretty sure you can fight back a little.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. You know? Just saying, like, a little survival instinct. You'd think she'd have
some. I agree. It's a little...
She should have been Predator 2 when she got to the city. She just should have used her skills in an urban setting.
Like, painted herself up like a building.
Yeah.
Like, concrete camouflage.
She should have been scaling buildings and, blending in. But, she's just a hot blonde lady running around.
The other thing about, like, the people being shitty, and I think why I went a little bit lower, is it doesn't feel like, other than our main dude, anybody that's shitty kind of gets direct retribution.
Yeah.
It's more just like general rampaging.
Yeah, and a lot of...
that one guy does get stepped on.
I'm saying the main bad guy, he gets his, but like the shitty guys...
Yeah, he needs to get it worse.
The shitty guys that were like, you know...
Poking him with sticks.
Caning him in the cage were like... Should have like gotten stepped on too.
Yeah. Yeah, there's a lot of people who are shitty to Mighty Peking Man who don't get any kind of anything. And then there's, like, innocent people who are just like, please, I didn't go to the show. Get fucking wrecked. So, yeah.
So it's my turn, I guess.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well. No, I like this one. 3 jocks, for sure. It's a fun little monster romp. I really like the... Right, box quote. I really like the terrible suit and the wanton building destruction.
Mm-hmm.
All the characters are kind of fall flat, but it's bizarre enough to be charming without being like, what the fuck is going on here? In a mean way, strange. So I really enjoyed it. It felt like the first part of it dragged a little bit, but it certainly picked up, especially by the time it was spinning a cougar on your shoulders, nookie time. or leopard? Is it a leopard?
Giant feline leopard, of sorts. Yeah.
Big cat. Yeah. Big cat. Yeah. My zookeeper friend would be mad at me. But 3 jocks, you should definitely watch this.
Yeah.
Don't expect greatness, just expect goodness.
I do want to say about the suit also, like, there are a couple different versions.
Yeah.
There's obviously guy in a suit. There's guy in a suit with a kind of mobile mouth for close-ups. And then there's basically a weird puppety thing for when the face just needs to go crazy with emotion or rage or whatever, which is just... I can't quite tell what it is. It's just a hand in a rubber mask moving around going, rah, rah. It's not human looking at all. It's really disturbing. But, you know, I mean, some of the Godzilla movies did that too, where they would like close up on the Godzilla head and it would be totally different. But it's interesting. I mean, they didn't just throw a guy in a gorilla outfit and say, go. They did some work. So, and the giant hand prop, I think, was surprisingly
decent. Really good.
Yeah. Like, people got on it and were carried around, and it didn't look like, you know, a crane covered in fur or anything. It, you know, kind of moved and bent like a hand, so. Yeah, there's some, I mean, you know, the effects are decent for late 70s, low-budget Hong Kong knockoff of King Kong, so. Yeah.
Yep, and I feel like we should note, Jens requested this long, long ago and actually sent us a DVD of it.
Yes.
Ages back, so we're glad to finally do it for him.
You're very... We are thankful, Jens. Thank you.
We appreciate the DVD, but damn, the Amazon one looks really good.
Well, let's take a break, shall we?
Okie dokie. I dropped my hot peanuts take in the chat.
Oh, shit. You blew it up.
Got hot nuts?
Yeah.
Mm. Speaking of nuts,
actually, out of Snickers. It's a lagoon. that's my favorite thing.
I'm going to legume all over your face.
So, second half. Anybody got anything?
Mm-hmm. I got another drink, you son of a bitch.
Yeah, okay. He's got another drink, you son of a bitch.
I don't think I like the Thomas Cullen.
More for me.
You want this?
No.
A bit watered down now, isn't it?
Yeah, well.
Still very good.
It's awfully limiting for me. Directly limiting.
That's fine.
I would drink it, but I got to drive home tonight, so.
Yeah. Thank you, though. Appreciate you.
I'll just eat the Snickers instead.
The Snickers.
The Snickers.
It's got almonds in it.
Oh. Mmm. Oh. Yeah, we understand, Jens. I mean, that was like, God, I think that was like 4 or 5 years ago now.
Yeah, it was this was at the other location, I think.
Yeah. Oh, definitely was over there. The old studio. I should just drink water out of my Gremlin's tiki.
Mm-hmm.
Never sully it with drink.
No. Plus, it fits the theme. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, it's hot in here because this is melted. I don't like it melted.
I don't like it.
I don't
like it.
Don't like it melted.
Yeah. So, because we watched this on streaming and what we're doing now, we're going to start giving away more stuff.
Mm-hmm.
We'll figure out exactly what we're doing, but we've got like basically a pile.
Yeah.
And we're probably going to like pick a winner every so often and just let them pick what they would like out of the pile.
Yeah.
So.
I think that works.
And I'm going to put this in the pile because we don't need it.
Don't worry. PJ's totally wrong about peanuts. Yeah, he kind of is. This is an almond Snickers, not even the peanuts.
Almonds.
Almond Snickers.
More Snickers.
So, for those of you patrons at the $5 level, new Futurama podcast in the morning. Enjoy. I couldn't even hear what he was saying. I heard him yelling something.
Mm. Yeah. Oh, and for you patrons at the $1 level, you now get another show.
What?
Yeah. We moved my extra credit Doctor Who show down to the $1 level because it's short and doesn't have very high production values. So, but it's a good advertisement for the $5 Doctor Who podcast. So it seemed like a good thing to bump down to the $1 level to get you a taste.
So yeah. Have you been posting the Who Yous on Friday after we recorded?
Like Tuesdays, the following Tuesday.
Yeah, it's always Tuesday.
Oh, okay.
So it's every other Tuesday.
I edit it that Friday and then set it up to schedule on Tuesday.
Yeah. I was just thinking, I mean, there's nothing really stopping us from putting something up on Patreon the same day as Banffcast Prime. We probably just wouldn't want to put something in the feed that for a while.
Yeah, no.
Yeah, I'm trying to put the Futurama ones on Thursdays.
Yeah.
And I just like just trying to stick with that Tuesday.
I like having content on a day. Doesn't matter if it's Patreon content or show content.
But yeah, we record Doctor Who.
What the hell I just did there?
So have you watched the Doctor Who for tomorrow that we're recording?
Yeah, I watched it last night.
Yeah, I watched it.
Okay, so we've all watched it. Yeah, there's going to be a lot of discussion on that one.
That's good. There needs
I'm going to have a lot of questions for
Excellent.
You guys.
Okay. I've read through some wikis and made sure my knowledge was correct on what I think you're going to ask me. So
yeah, there's a lot of things,
one in the beginning that definitely is like, hey, if you know what's going on, here's the thing. Otherwise,
that first
it's
scene, I knew there were a ton of Easter eggs that were happening because there couldn't not be, you know.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, so you got something? You got something?
I do.
Nothing.
Nothing. We got two voicemails. We got an email.
Voicemails.
I'm going to use the bathroom real quick while he looks this up.
Sweet.
That way I'm not at the end.
Get on them voicemails.
All right, wrap it up.
Wrap it up.
Hello.
Hello. Chase sent us an email of Shaw Brothers recommendations.
Ah.
And it's a good list.
There was one on there we'd already done, but had not hit the regular feed yet. So thank you, Chase. The other one, there's another one on the list that we are doing this week. So thank you, Chase. the others we will look into. So.
You have one new voicemail.
Should be two.
I know, but
you
one,
just want
one of them's already marked as red. So
I.
Sweet booze.
Glad I made a drink Chuck liked.
Oh, Jesus. For a second, I thought that meant that the voicemail was 18 minutes long. It means it was 18 minutes ago. It was
sent. Oh, oh.
Holy shit. If they would stop changing their interface every other day, maybe I could follow along with what Jerks. Something Google does.
Jerks. Hey, who's this BJ imposter in the chat?
What? There's another BJ.
There's two.
Always goes to violence first.
That's how you deal with an imposter.
What's this? Fight me. We will sort it out later. With fists. Tom Collins is really good, you guys.
I can tell.
Really good.
And no, Scott, I have not followed any of the Japanese Spider-Man stuff aside from weird memes that I see every once in a while.
Mm, weird memes.
I know I should, but I got a lot on my plate right now.
Got a lot on my plate.
We're doing a lot of shows.
Well, you're talking about the animated one, right?
No, there's a live action one.
Yeah, yeah, no. I mean, that's all the memes I see are from the
animated. I've seen other ones.
Oh, okay.
There's, yeah.
I guess I'm behind on the meme machine.
It's a real meme machine. My mommy says my daddy's a real meme machine.
Gremlin.
Who's
difficult to drink? Who's Gremlin?
Deep throating the mic. Who?
Is it me?
I don't know.
What?
Somebody says.
Maybe me.
What are you? Are you sucking down the mic over there?
No.
What's going on?
I'm all right. It's holding up my face.
Jesus, Chuck, get it together.
I'm a professional.
Stay on target.
Professional podcaster.
Don't forget about that cherry. And don't forget about tying that stem in a knot.
Don't you worry. I can do it. Oh. I just grossed myself out. Ah!
You mean even more so than you just over there, like, fondling yourself?
I was enjoying myself there for a moment, and I was like...
It's a Tom Collins, not fucking ecstasy, dude.
Maybe. So hot, though.
Maybe it was.
Shirt off.
Maybe those weren't sugar cubes.
Oh, shit.
I mean...
X gonna give it to you.
Wow. Let me unleash... That suddenly explains a lot.
Let me unleash this left titty.
Wow.
Please don't, Chuck.
It wasn't a Tom Collins at all. It was a Cliff Huxtable.
Oh.
And so...
No.
Did anyone address the Neil Breen stuff while I was in the...
I don't know.
Who showed up in the chat from
BJ. What's a Neil Breen?
I don't know what it is.
I don't know.
They are like,
oh, shit,
like,
yeah.
Like the room almost yeah, level no, okay, of I know. What I the know shit is this movie.
Oh, right.
That's the dude that has like the same almost, cover for every single
yeah,
one of those
movies. Yeah, we've almost done Fateful Findings like yes. 5 or 6 times, and now everybody else has done it yeah. since we almost did it, and yeah. we're kind of like, we don't know if we want to do it anytime soon. And
I don't think that's what we want at this point anymore. I mean, finding it is one thing. Coming
yeah,
along late to the party.
I feel like it might end up being a Dangerous Men situation, too, where it's yeah. just like, this is, you know, I think with Dangerous Men, so many people, like, want to make it a thing.
Yeah.
When it's really like, it's not that.
It was like, this is the next thing, you guys. And it's yeah. like, well, maybe it's not.
No, it's not.
Yeah. So.
Anyway.
Breen.
We'll do it at some point, but.
We'll check it out. We'll maybe. Screen yeah. it.
I know he's crowdfunding his next one.
So. Oh, that's good.
Yeah, that always works.
Good for you, Neil.
Yeah,
Breen.
Ask Samurai Cop 2 and Kung Fury.
Mm-hmm. You all right?
No, I just don't bring up that. Please.
Yeah,
I know.
That was a bad time.
So, You guys want to do a second half?
I sure do.
All right. Yeah.
What? Yes?
Mm, yes.
All right.
I am on board with the second half.
Got to warm up the clapper here.
Yeah.
All right, and welcome back.
Hey.
Hey.
Hey. Mavcast, second half.
Hey.
Half number two, the secondiest half.
Yep.
Sure.
The half where we talk about more movies.
Right.
Right. Which Man. Is what we're going to do.
Okay.
Who's got what?
FX has the movies.
I have a thing. My thing is quick.
Oh, okay.
I've heard.
Make it snappy.
Son of a bitch.
Sorry, you left it wide open.
I did. So, okay.
Yeah,
just serving it up.
Please tell us about what you watched, Chuck.
Okay, I will. So, just recently on Sunday ended the HBO series Big Little Lies. Mm-hmm. And it is a limited run show. It was all written and directed by the same people, so it's basically one big long movie.
Mm-hmm.
And I just want to say that that is a very entertaining 7 hours of television. It's based on a book, but it was adapted by David E. Kelley, who has written a fuck ton of television.
Yep.
And there are a ton of people in it. When it started, it didn't really seem like it was something in my wheelhouse. It didn't seem like something I'd be interested in, and I kind of hated everybody, but I kind of came around to like hating a lot of them characters. So it's just one of those things that it's one of those HBO shows that I think kind of flew under the radar. It didn't get that massive, like, oh my God, you have to watch this thing.
Yeah.
So I just wanted to say that that's really good and everyone should watch it.
Okay.
So
if we're talking TV.
Uh-huh.
Okay.
I want to talk another show.
Okay.
That just recently ended.
All right.
Called Review.
Oh, yeah.
By Andy Daly.
I've heard people lamenting about this ending.
Oh, my God. Okay. Review is the story of Forrest McNeil, who is a guy who he reviews life experiences for his TV show.
Mm-hmm.
So one will be like, all you can eat pancakes. Review them. And being a woman. And just being cryogenically frozen. And all, like, just, it's... There are only two shows that I think ended perfectly. Like ended up, their entire run was perfect. And it's The British Office and Review.
Mm-hmm.
Review ends on what might be one of the most genius endings I think I've ever seen on a TV show.
Mm-hmm.
And I don't say that lightly. But Andy Daly is so good. And this show is basically in the vein of, all right, let's take this innocuous thing and take it as far and as dark as it can go. And that show does in every way. It is dark, dark genius.
Hmm.
And it is one of the funniest things I've ever seen. And the ending came out of the blue. I had no idea it was the actual last episode.
Mm-hmm.
Because it's only the third episode of the season.
I was going to say, it seemed like a lot of people were like, wait, this is over?
Yeah. I was stunned. Hmm. And like there was actually an article that came up that was like, yeah, that really was the finale. Wow. And that's why the ending is so good, because it's just like, oh my God, are you fucking kidding me right now?
Hmm.
But yes, like, yeah, watch Review.
What channel is that on?
Comedy Central.
Okay.
I believe it's on the app, because it's tough to find anything. It's one of those shows, like, if they put out a Blu-ray set, I will buy it immediately.
Nice.
But it's nice in that it's only, I think, 22 total episodes.
So it's like a British show.
Yeah.
Nice and compact.
Yeah, where it went, and it's all planned out, and it all has heavy continuity, because this guy basically destroys his life by being a reviewer. And it's got this weird commentary on actually doing reviews of things, in that it's like, if you're always analyzing things, you can't enjoy anything anymore. And I think that becomes the message of the entire show.
Mm.
And how... You know, how far will somebody go to try to be objective about reviewing things when, you know, reviews are inherently subjective? So, it's really fucking good.
Hmm.
But yeah, so it to me, follows the lead of The British Office in being a perfect series that didn't go on too long, did every episode well, and got out while the getting was good.
Hmm. Cool.
So, okay. Yeah. So, watch it.
So, I'm going to kind of re-review something / add a new review to the pile.
Okay.
I rewatched Rogue One.
Ah.
A Star Wars Story.
Right. Yeah.
Hmm.
I remember that movie.
Well, it's funny you should phrase that that way, because I'm pretty sure if you take a year or two away from me, I'm going to remember basically nothing from that movie. And it's... Believe me, I want to like that movie. I want to like that movie more than I do. And in rewatching it, I think I was a little too forgiving on things that in the long run will annoy me.
Mm-hmm.
In wanting to like that, because if you're of a certain age, I think you want Star Wars movies to be good.
Yeah.
Inherently. And especially when you painstakingly attempt to tie it into the original movie, you want them to pull that off well. I'm thinking that their problem was in choice of director. Because much the same way as like whatever year Godzilla movie was.
2014.
Yeah. I don't remember shit from that movie. Like nothing at all. I remember the Halo jump. And
I remember what made me mad about Godzilla, but I don't remember details.
I mean, I think Bryan Cranston was in it briefly.
He was.
And I know we had this conversation last week, but it's just the only things I remember. The Halo jump, Bryan Cranston for a couple minutes, and adding fuel to my, like, if you play husband and wife, don't play brother and sister or vice versa.
Mm-hmm.
So.
Oh, right.
Yeah. So you have Quicksilver and Scarlet Witch are married in that one. So, again, like I said, it's a weird little pet peeve of my own.
Well,
but I'm just saying, like, there is almost nothing memorable about that movie, and I feel like if you took Star Wars out of the title, this would be the same way. Because, I mean, it really only starts to directly tie into the movie in, like, the last 10 minutes. Because, I mean, otherwise, they could be going after and doing just about anything.
Mm-hmm.
And, like, on a long enough timeline, I'm going to go back to Rogue One and be like, yeah, Donnie Yen was cool. And that's about it. And man, CG Tarkin is not aging well, because it was bad when it came out, and it looks even worse now. Whatever. I'm not saying I hate Rogue One. I'm just thinking I don't like it very much.
Well, all right.
In rewatching it, so
is it fine?
It's okay. Like it's. I think it gets by on being a Star Wars movie, and if it were anything else, it'd just be completely forgotten.
I mean, honestly, that is why I've not gone back and watched The Force Awakens, because I remember coming away from it saying, it's good, not great, but then thinking about it, I'm like, but that, and then I was like, you know what, no.
Yeah,
I'm not that vested anymore to really, like, I gotta go back and reevaluate this, you know.
I've gone back and rewatched that, too. I think it falls a little bit prey to what a lot of J.J. Abrams things do, where in first viewing, it's really awesome, and mm-hmm. then when you start to think about certain things, it might fall apart a little bit if you're going to get hung up on that.
Right.
But to me, that one I think will endure more, and probably even more so when you add it to the next two part of the trilogy. Mm-hmm. Like, Rogue One has nothing to tie it to except for the original movie, which right. is...
Well, the character work in Force Awakens is way better.
Yeah, I think so. I mean, I can't tell you anyone's name except for Jyn Erso, and I just watched it. Like, I can't even tell you the robot's name. It was like K2, I think.
K2SO. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. I remember that because of the mountain. literally, like, I'm just mean there's just not a lot going on that makes that movie memorable to me. Anyway, so I'm done, whatever, internet shitting on Rogue One. So I wanted to kind of complete the journey, because I've now mentioned two, and I realized that I've never seen Gareth Edwards' first movie, Monsters.
Mm-hmm.
It'd been long in my queue to just go ahead and watch. Prior to this, you know, I think I meant to watch it before Godzilla came out, kind of thing. I just never got around to it, and right. I was like, you know what, it's on Netflix, I'm going to watch it, just to have a comparison piece and kind of complete the journey of his movies.
Mm-hmm.
Monsters is kind of weird. Like, at first I thought it was going to be like a found footage movie, because that's how it feels like it starts, but it's not, thankfully, at all. And I know I say thankfully, even though I've watched all the found footage movies, it seems like. It's weird, because to me, like, having gone back and watched Monsters, I think makes Godzilla even worse, because you realize it's almost the same movie, mm-hmm. and it uses almost the same tricks, where about the only difference is like the monsters in Monsters, or the aliens in Monsters, are original. And when Godzilla occasionally shows up in Godzilla, it's like, hey, that's Godzilla.
Right.
You know, that's about the only difference is like they're super cagey about showing them. Mm-hmm. You know, there's a lot more talk about them than there are actually showing them, which is fine. You know, like I said, I think it worked for this movie. No, don't get me wrong. I mean, it sounds like I'm immediately starting to shit on Monsters too. I think Monsters is pretty good. I think Monsters is something that somebody should watch. In fact, I would say watch that and skip Godzilla if you, for some reason, haven't seen any of his movies. Because other than a bigger budget, Monsters is far more interesting.
Hmm.
And it's carried just by basically two main leads. I mean, that you're basically following two people. Other people float in and out of the movie, but you're following these two people through their little journey.
Hmm.
And again, it's like, it's pretty good. And I mean, for a freshman effort, you know, like never having really directed a full length, like actual movie, you know, I think he did a TV movie or visual effects and things like that. And some TV episodes, you know, for a freshman, actual full length motion picture, it's pretty damn good. And I can see why it was like, people saw it and were like, oh shit, let's get this guy a bigger budget. I feel like he's, I don't want to say mediocre, but like a kind of a standard director who's been like given two keys to giant kingdoms and he's not ready for them. You know, like, I mean, I just don't feel like he was ready for either one. I feel like he needed a couple more movies to perfect his craft before being given freaking Godzilla and Star Wars. I mean,
that doesn't happen anymore though.
No, I mean,
I think they just, who's worked with special effects? All right, give them a little more special effects.
Yeah, I mean, like I said, I mean, Monsters gets by basically on performance alone. I mean, the anticipation of things happening is greater than when they actually do.
Mm-hmm.
And there is a couple cheap pops, if you will. Like, there is a couple like really dumb. Like, you think something's going to happen, and then like something else makes a noise, and like that's really kind of annoying at this point. Like, I feel like I thought we'd kind of grown past that. I mean,
right.
I know the movie came out like 2010, but I think even by then it was like, really, you're doing like loud noise to make me jump at something that didn't actually happen.
Right.
Like, I don't know. It doesn't happen that often. It's just, there's a couple, like there was one real egregious one. I was like, oh, really? Like, it was like a fucking backfire or something too. It's just like, you're just like, oh shit, something's about to happen. Cause the music dropped out, and then it's like car backfires. And it's like, oh, fuck you. But I still think it's worth watching, and yeah, I don't know. To me, it's like, pick one of the two, and you know, I guess watch Star Wars because it's Star Wars, and
yeah,
you know. But I think that's the thing is if I hadn't just watched this movie last night, I think I'd already be starting to forget things about it too. Unfortunately, it's just he doesn't seem like he's a memorable director. Like, it just doesn't craft scenes that are like going to stick with you forever. Oh, I don't know.
I like the scale that he works on in a lot of the big scenes, but yeah, character work, I don't think he's quite there yet.
Yeah, and that's weird because, like I said, the strength of Monsters is its two characters.
Mm-hmm.
I mean,
so he just kind of abandoned that since then.
It's weird. Yeah, I mean, like, yeah, I mean, it's actually really good because you don't get too much into their backstory. They're basically two people that have been thrown together in this situation that don't know each other prior to. And you get some backstory, but like, not like, hey, we just met, let's just exposit our entire backstory. It's pieces. It's the important stuff. And it's genuinely kind of earnest. And it's funny, 'cause it's like when the movie started, the credits came up prior to me actually seeing them. And the main guy in it is that Scoot McNairy, which I mainly only remembered him because of his funny name.
Mm-hmm.
But like, he's really damn Scoot. Good. He's really damn good at
he's
it.
He's on Halt and Catch Fire,
yeah.
And he's really good.
Yeah, and the lady that's in it, I mean, like, I think the only other movie, I looked through her filmography really quickly, like, I think the only movie I'd seen that she'd been in was All the Boys Love Mandy Lane.
Ah.
And, like, she's really good, too. Like, it's just strange. I was like, who are you? Mm. Like, why have I not seen you in more movies?
Yeah.
But, I don't know.
Hmm.
Like I said, I felt like it was a weird thing where I needed to watch the rest of this guy's movies and apparently revisit some. I might revisit Godzilla just for shits and giggles, but I just, like I said, the best part of that was the trailer, and I mean the Halo jump, and they show that in the damn trailer, you know.
Yeah.
So, speaking of Star Wars and Rogue One, you want some emails?
Yeah,
that relate to Star Wars and Rogue One.
Oh,
maybe we sure. do.
Don't yeah. I?
First one up is from Jay from Vegas.
Mm-hmm.
He says it's Rouge One, a Star Wars makeup story. He says, hey, BMF crew, Jagus here, and I just got out of Rogue One. That movie could sure use a chainsaw to the first half, but once they get past setting up their story with the urgency of molasses in a blizzard, the game, the movie gets good, and overall it was worth the $3 ticket price because it was in three dimensions. Anyway, if you get this before April 1st, just know my love for your podcast is no joke. Jay, sent from my, from Gary Witta's Google Plus account he constantly promoted on the Tested podcast.
Nice. Well, you paid a dollar per dimension for it. That's a pretty good deal.
Yeah. Not bad. Not bad. Glad you liked it, kind of. Yeah, I mean, the second half is clearly much better than the first half, but first half is also where there's a lot of things got chopped up, and you can just tell by the trailers, you know.
Mm-hmm.
You know what happens in the second half?
Yeah. Y-wings. Y-wings show up and go slow and then bomb stuff.
Go slow.
They fly real slow.
Slow-ass Y-wings.
All right.
They're not that slow.
We'll get back to the other Star Wars stuff in a minute, but we got one from Chase, which, go figure, relates to Shaw Brothers movies.
Oh, yeah. We were talking about this during the break.
Yeah. Do you want me to read the whole thing? It's a lot of recommendations and stuff.
No.
Yeah, I think we'll save it for our thing, because we've already done one that hasn't gone to the main feed yet, and one that we were already going to do anyway. So yeah. It's basically just a list of recommendations, right? Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah. Hold off on that one.
Okay.
We have some voicemails. Do you want to hear one?
I think we have a Star Wars voicemail.
Oh, we have two of them.
Two Star Wars voicemails?
Yeah. They're both about Star Wars?
Holy shit.
They are. Do the one from yesterday first.
Okay.
That'll work a little better.
Hey, Bamscast. This is the Jade Dinosaur speaking, calling from the West Coast. I actually have a Star Wars movie question. Which is this? Okay, so I don't like the new Star Wars movies. I did not like Force Awakens at all. I kind of grew up with the prequels, so while I don't like them, I'm kind of content to just let them lie and not too offended by them. And with all the problems that I now know about with Jedi, which I didn't know about before, Look, the question is this. Is Empire Strikes Back such a good movie that it's starting to hurt the rest of the Star Wars movies that have come out after it? I mean, isn't it like a joke in Hollywood that when somebody wants to make a sequel, they say, hey, this is going to be our empire? And I don't necessarily believe this myself. It's just something I've been thinking about. I think it only really hurts the franchise when you really think about it. So, but just wanted to know your thoughts, since, well, it's freaking Empire Strikes Back. So, hope you guys are having a good one. Oh, and Mackie, just so you know, the only thing I'm married to is revenge for Spider-Man 2. Ooh.
Man. clearly a guy who likes subplot, no main plot.
What,
go figure.
What happened? What's the Spider-Man 2? Do I not know the best
Spider-Man 2? I always rag on Spider-Man 2.
Oh.
Because everyone's like, it's the best comic book movie ever. I'm like,
it's the best Spider-Man movie to date.
Is it?
Yes.
No, the first one is, actually. Mm-mm. But anyway.
The stupid Green Goblin
three,
costume.
Of course, Chuck says
Spider-Man 3. The stupid
Green
Goblin costume undoes everything good in the first one.
Yeah. I just wish 2 had a plot, but, you know, whatever. Anyway, Empire is kind of like, the thing about Empire is it was an impossible task that they somehow pulled off.
Mm-hmm.
Making a sequel to Star Wars that's just as good and actually somehow was better and made everything about the original Star Wars better. And it's impossible. Like, I still don't know how they did it, to be totally honest. You know? And I think about the way I wrote my Letterboxd review when I watched the prequels before, or not prequels, God, Jesus Christ. No, watch the originals before going into Force Awakens.
Well, now they too are the prequels.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, yeah, it's all getting fucked up now. But but the way I wrote it is, my favorite scene of all time is the carbon freeze scene.
Mm-hmm.
It's a scene that I think is absolutely, utterly perfect. And then they one up it 15 minutes later. And that kind of is this microcosm for me of Empire Strikes Back versus Star Wars. Star Wars is something I love dearly. And yet somehow they took everything from that and they one-upped it,
mm-hmm.
which just can't, it doesn't happen anymore. And nowadays you can't also you can't make a movie with a twist like that. Everyone's going to know about it and everyone's going to spoil it.
Yeah.
Immediately, as soon as it hits the streets.
The thing that Empire does to its benefit is that by being the dark middle chapter, it doesn't have to have an ending.
Mm-hmm.
And so therefore you can do really cool dramatic shit and not have to resolve it. So when you're not rushing towards a finale, when you're not going towards resolution and you're just setting up more stuff, it's all intriguing as shit. It's all super fascinating. It's all potential. Mm-hmm. It's all, where is this going to go? How are they going to get out of it? And that sets your imagination on fire.
Mm-hmm.
Whereas, you know, Star Wars has an ending. Return of the Jedi has an ending. This is all just like, oh my God, could you believe that? How is this going to, I mean, it's the ultimate cliffhanger. And people love that shit. Like season finales of TV shows that have cliffhangers, that's all anyone talks about for months until the show comes back. That's what sparks your imagination.
Yeah.
It doesn't hurt either that it's a finely made motion picture also, but I think it's because it doesn't fall into the trap of having to end.
Mm-hmm.
It just stops. So.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, if everyone sets out to make Empire as their sequel, I don't know why they haven't actually watched it. Because so many sequels are just like, hey, what worked in the first one? Put more of it in there.
Yeah.
And that rarely ever works.
Right.
I mean, Empire added basically one new character. I mean, one new main character.
Well, two, if you count Lando.
Well, I am counting Lando. Well, I guess Yoda. I guess Yoda. I mean, yeah, all right.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, but I...
Yeah, I mean, I'm just saying, like, most of them have been like, well, what, you've met Darth Vader, what about Jeff Vader? And he's,
what about Darth Mater?
Yeah. Oh, don't say that too loud, because Disney will put fucking Toe Mater in the next Star Wars movie.
I think Darth there is Mater. A Darth Mater.
Oh, okay.
Like a toy or something out there.
Of course there fucking is. But I'm saying, like, you know, most every other movie, it's like, well, we need three villains in this one and six in the next one. Yeah. And
well, and so many of them, too, have gone, well, we're filming two and three back to back. And so we don't have to finish two. Mm-hmm. Whereas Empire Strikes Back, the third act resolves itself.
Yep.
Like it doesn't just end on a cliffhanger. The cliffhanger is more the entire thing. Like, oh, fuck, where do we go from here?
Mm-hmm.
Not, oh, fuck, how does this resolve itself?
Mm-hmm.
There's a big difference between those two.
Mm-hmm.
And I think so many, you know, like, you know, the Matrix has always been one of the bigger ones where it's just like dun 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 ending. And it's like that, who was that guy again?
Yeah.
I don't even remember, you know, but it's like they all want to. And I think, God, I barely remember anything from those 45 hour long Pirates of the Caribbean sequels. But I remember that the second one just ends and they're like, all right, come back next year for part three, you know, and it's Empire Strikes Back ends.
Yeah.
It has a very definitive third act that concludes itself properly. And I think that's the big difference with so many of them that people miss.
Yeah, it does end, but I think it doesn't Star Wars ends. Like they blow up the thing, they have an award ceremony. You could have never had another Star Wars movie and thought everything is probably okay.
Yeah.
Except for Chewbacca not getting a medal.
Yeah, for real.
Yeah. Well, I'm sure someone set up a petition. Maybe he got it.
He did get a medal like 25 years later at the MTV Movie Awards.
Yeah.
Right, that's right.
Given out by Carrie Fisher.
Yeah.
R.I.P.
I just think there's so much unresolved in Empire. Especially pertaining to lead characters.
They add more questions for you to care about.
Yes.
That were not there before.
Yeah, because Star Wars really doesn't end with questions. The only question is like, well, Darth Vader kind of flew away.
Mm-hmm.
Wonder what that's all about.
Yeah.
Empire's like this and this. And what about him? Where's he? And what? And, you know, all of that. It's the ultimate cliffhanger.
Like, Star Wars was a movie made not in a vacuum, but it was made like, all right, here's our movie.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
Here is a movie. And then
they can say the whole time they had like this whole thing mapped out, but it was just like, let's make Star Wars and then maybe we'll get to make another one. It was, I mean, you know, you may have had ideas for Empire, but you were not. Right. Setting forth to make a trilogy from the get-go.
Mm-hmm. Right.
There's no way. But, you know, like, Back to the Future 2 is the same kind of, not really dark middle chapter, but it's that same kind of, like, it has its own little story that resolves, but the bigger picture is left completely open.
Yeah.
That kind of thing. Back to the Future 2 is not as good as Back to the Future, though. So,
oh God, no.
yeah, it's just, but
it's a dragon everyone's going to be chasing.
Yeah,
and I don't think you can make it that sort of thing these days, because if any sequel can't surprise anyone anymore.
Yeah,
it just can't. There's too much. There's too much that goes into marketing. There's too much that goes into social media. There's too much that goes into everything for anyone to ever be able to pull it off anymore.
Mm-hmm.
You know, J.J. Abrams had to threaten people on Force Awakens with basically, like, you'll never work in Hollywood again. We'll find out if you leak anything.
Yeah.
You know, and even then, it was just, it didn't really matter.
And then, like, what, photos, you know, of stuff snuck out.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But here's the deal. Don't, if you're making a sequel, don't try to make Empire. Make your movie.
And tell your story.
Tell your story. Tell more of your story in your world.
Mm-hmm.
Don't chase somebody else's world, man.
Yeah.
Don't go chasing waterfalls. Stick to the rivers and the lakes that you're used to.
I mean, you know, a lot of people just, they put, like, Empire and Godfather 2 are on that plane of, like, man, the first movie was amazing. The second one, holy shit, how did they mm-hmm. top it? Like, there are plenty of movie sequels that ended up being better than the original. The Star Trek 2 is better than Star Trek the Motion Picture.
Mm-hmm.
Stuff like that. But it's basically the strength of those two movies. Those two movies got lumped into this, like, kind of like art movie, popcorn movie double feature of these things improved on the original in ways that no one saw coming. So I think in a lot of ways people are going after that goal, not necessarily like Star Wars movies are ruined because Empire. It's just that they're just more Star Wars movies, and it's how do you do any of it?
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, I think the reason Force Awakens didn't necessarily be one of, even though, like, the consensus was, yeah, it's better than the prequels, I think the reason that a lot of people came out of that and went, that's fine, that's a good movie, that's not a great movie, but it's a good movie, is because of how familiar it was to the original blueprint of Star Wars.
Mm-hmm.
Because there was nothing, like, shock, there was no new plot devices in it, basically. It all kind of went the same way, just with different people stuck into the
yeah.
plot points. So, and I think they did that for a reason. I think they did that to kind of put a warm blanket over the fans and just tell everybody it's going to be okay.
100%.
Yeah. Yes, yeah. They didn't want to just go venture off on their own and be like, we tried and we totally fucked it up. They're like, hey, let's just kind of, this is Star Wars. Everything's going to be fine, you guys. So
I think our next movie, no, not our, maybe not our next chronological movie, like not the next movie that we get, but the next, you know, Star Wars proper numbered movie is going to, that's going to be where we go off the rails in the new direction, I hope.
Yeah. That's going to be the test right there, is like, okay, what is this?
Yeah.
You know,
yeah. But if it's Mark Hamill being Yoda,
yeah,
to Rey,
right,
being Luke, then yeah.
Yeah.
I don't know.
I do one thing I and it's kind of an insignificant movie at this point, but City Slickers 2, for some reason, the people in that movie are obsessed with The Godfather 2,
mm-hmm.
and that just makes that movie work for me, because they're so obsessed with how good Godfather 2 is compared to the first one, and they talk about it for the whole movie.
Yeah.
And it's like, okay, I get it. You guys are like, how can you make a sequel to something everyone loved? Well, let's just keep referencing Godfather 2, and maybe that will rub off a little bit on it. So,
yeah. So, with episode 8, I mean, I don't want to be in this mindset, but I am already, I'm at levels that I haven't been since before Phantom Menace came out. I am more excited about this than I probably should be. A, it's the middle chapter of this new trilogy. B, it's Rian Johnson.
Mm-hmm.
So, like, to me, like, the deck is stacked. Like, it, this could be my make or break Star Wars thing, is what I'm trying to get at. Like, yeah. If this doesn't, like, live up, I'm not saying it has to, I still have some mediation there. Like, I'm not like, it has to be this good or it sucks.
Mm-hmm.
But I'm just saying, like, if it's not really good, I might be mostly out for Star Wars. Like, stop caring.
Well, and at some point they're going to move beyond us.
Yeah,
I'm sure they're going to have to. And I mean, I'm not saying this as an offense towards Jade, who was saying that, you know, he kind of grew up with the prequels and that's mm-hmm. his jam, but that's the crowd that's going to be going forward. Mm-hmm. There're going to be a lot of people wandering off of the original Star Wars movies. Just mm-hmm. people getting old. and losing interest and dying. I mean, it's just, that's where we're going. And the bulk of the audience is going to be fans of the prequels. And that's where it's going to go. So these movies are either going to start catering to that crowd, or they're going to have to carve out their own thing. And that's why 8 has to be the thing that carves out its own thing. Otherwise, you know exactly what they're going to be doing from here on out, which is just catering to whoever.
Yeah. And I guess the way I see it also, the prequels didn't chase me off. So the new ones would have to be really astoundingly bad to chase me off.
Like, chasing me all the way off? No, probably not. But, like, probably would at least move into wait for it to come on video, honestly.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't see...
I don't think I'd be able to do that.
I think if 8 is just okay, and then 9 comes out, like, and the day of 9, everybody goes, holy fuck! You'd be in the theater that night.
Maybe, yeah.
Yeah.
Like, for me, I didn't see 2 until DVD, and I didn't see 3 until cable. Like, that was my progression of just like, man, what, this is, I'm not excited for this.
Yeah. I mean, I gotta say, I so don't care about them making the young Han Solo movie. I think that's gonna be shit.
Yeah, I don't either.
I mean, I like some of the cast that's happening in it, but I think that movie's gonna be a piece of shit.
I don't like visiting that stuff.
No, I do not either.
Yeah.
I mean, it's a whole fucking galaxy of shit you can do. Don't keep retreading.
Well, and they're already doing, like, guess what Han Solo's real name's going to be.
Yeah, it's like,
you know, it's like, fuck off.
Who the fuck cares? Why would anyone care?
I hope it's a swerve and they're like, it's actually Han Solo. He's just got a cool fucking name. Deal with it.
San Holo. Right. Just thought that sounded...
San Duo.
Yeah. He had a partner. They broke up.
Mm-hmm. Real quick on the... Yeah, right. Real quick on the generation thing. Like, I don't know, man. I know... Like, every geek dad mom out there that I know is, they're not, like, forcing that on their children, but they're like, hey, this is a thing I like. It's called Star Wars.
Yeah.
And the kids take to it.
Oh, sure.
So, fan base, I don't think is going to be dwindling off anytime soon.
Yeah. Fair enough. One last little thought. The only other thing, like, if you're not going to chase... This is a really sticky wicket, as far, no pun intended, for Star Wars. If you're going to do a sequel and you don't necessarily want to chase after like Empire, you can take the Alien to Aliens route and make a completely different genre of movie. Totally. But you have to be fucking careful.
Yeah.
Because, like, there are ones that cross genres and people are like, what is this? Fuck it. You know, like, it wasn't, you know, a horror movie to an action movie, but it still feels like it's in the same universe.
I feel like that's really dangerous these days.
It's very dangerous.
Especially because of how much people know about a movie before it comes out.
Yeah.
Like, Alien to Aliens, you know, you didn't have the fucking internet for everybody to learn every little thing about it and, like, practically get a shooting script the day that the movie starts production. But
Aliens is what you had to do. You had to do Aliens because...
Absolutely.
Because when they go back... When it's Alien 3 time and it's just like, well, we're back to one alien and it's just chasing people down hallways, you're like, yeah, you guys did that already. You know? Mm-hmm. Aliens came along and was just like, we're not doing that. We're doing our own thing. It's going to be fucking badass. And it's going to be exactly in the same universe. It's not going to feel like it's apart from that universe. So.
Anyway.
That's why all the, like, subsequent Alien movies are just like, what are you guys doing? You can't keep going back and chasing Alien. You can't.
Well, yeah. The creature's lost its mystique.
Yeah.
So, and you can't get that back.
No.
But.
And that's why the potential of Prometheus was so big, because it was like, hey, you got an origin story, kind of, but there's a lot more going on here. Maybe it'll be interesting. And it was just like, no, it's just going to be whatever it was.
Yeah. I'm still going to see Covenant.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm still going to see it.
But, yeah.
I am not optimistic. Yeah. Especially the way the marketing for that movie is going, too.
Mm-hmm.
They're doing, like, the whole, like, they're having, like, a death bracket for all the characters. And it's like, fuck off. Like, if you think...
Wait, what?
Yes. They like, on their Facebook page, they've had, like, Danny McBride or the other guy, who's going to die? And it's like, if you think Danny McBride is making it out of this movie alive, you haven't seen a fucking movie in your life, for Christ's sake.
No.
That sounds real dumb.
They've also kind of given away, like, characters who get face-hugged already, which is really fucking stupid.
For Christ's sake.
Yeah, it's like, you guys. Like, see, this is what I mean. Like, marketing and social media and everything will ruin your movie.
Yeah.
Like, unless a movie comes out in a goddamn, like, the director is just goes Herzog on him, is like, you cannot do anything that I don't approve of ever.
Well, that's
the only way that's going to happen.
That's why the running line of Cloverfield things, and there's supposedly another Cloverfield thing coming pretty soon, they've been mixed results, but I love the fact that they're just like, here it is. And it's like, what is this? When did you make this? And it's like, it's out now. And you're like, what? Yeah. That's awesome. I love that there are still ways to make a movie in secret. Mm-hmm. Most movies should be made in secret.
Amen.
Yeah. That would solve so much.
Yeah. You're not entitled to know everything from the set.
Give me one teaser. Give me one trailer. Mm-hmm. Give me a poster.
Mm-hmm. And that's it.
Yeah. That's all I need.
I don't need vlogs.
I mean, it's fucking Star Wars. The teaser for Force Awakens could have been a black screen and just...
Yep.
Like right? A flick out of a lightsaber, yeah. And people will be like, just says, come in their pants.
Yeah.
Just, like, the I will be there. Star Tell Wars. Me when.
You'll fucking see it.
Yeah.
Yeah, well, like, when they came up to my house and knocked on my door. But when I learned of the name for episode 8, I was like, cool, I'm in.
Yeah,
mm-hmm.
That's all I need.
Mm-hmm. Sign me the fuck up. I was already signed up, but, you know,
yeah,
write it in pen this time.
Yeah. Yep. So,
mm-hmm.
Another voicemail.
Oh, right.
That might be related to Star Wars.
Oh, shit.
Cool.
Here we go.
Let's just get it over with.
Hey, Bamcast. This is Scott from Seattle. Let me turn my radio down. I'm watching the live stream. Cat reminded me about how I told you about my brother-in-law who pretty much only watches movies after a certain date within his lifetime. I found that that's not always true because recently he showed his wife, my sister, all of the Star Wars movies, because it was her first time, apparently. Somehow she missed them. And her favorite Star Wars movie is Episode 1, The Phantom Menace. Scott out.
That's a broken woman.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
It's a broken woman. I feel bad for her.
People are entitled to their opinions.
No, they're not, Chuck.
I mean...
People are entitled to my opinion.
They are entitled to their opinions, even if they're categorically wrong.
I'm curious, though.
Provably false.
Yeah, provably
false. In what order?
Criteria.
Well, I'm curious what order they were shown in. Like, was it 4, 5, 6, then 1, 2, and 3? Because if they started with 1, 2, 3, I can see how a lot of people would be like, yeah, that first Star Wars thingy I saw, that was the best. That's, you know, for people who aren't that interested in a thing, that can happen.
Well, and it's also, like, it can always be like, I really like Liam Neeson.
Sure.
And so suddenly that, like, Liam Neeson's my favorite. So that's her favorite Star Wars, because, you know, you just never know what people's criteria is.
How can anything with that piece of shit Anakin Skywalker be anybody's favorite?
And Jar Jar.
I don't know.
You know what, though?
I don't know.
If you,
people with kids?
If you live in a household where you are forbidden from watching older movies because of technology or whatever reason, and you watch the prequels first, you are probably going to be predisposed to like the prequels first because you are not allowed to watch movies that have technology in them, and the technology in the prequels is better than the technology in 4, 5, and 6.
I disagree. I think the prequels have aged worse because of CG.
Mm-hmm.
I really do. I think... But then again, she could have also seen the special editions of the new ones with the fucking Jabba scene and the... And the beak mouth and the sarlacc.
It's generally most likely because anything else has been pretty much erased. Yeah. Yeah.
That's unfortunate, but...
I mean, even if you're a big fan of Liam Neeson acting like a father figure and then ultimately dying, there's only about 6 other movies you could choose from.
Yeah.
But
and they're all called Taken.
No, he doesn't die.
He doesn't die.
I know.
He also doesn't act like a very good father figure.
I know.
I was referring more to, well, let's see, Batman, Kingdom of Heaven. I can do this. There's a lot more where he was like, I'm going to teach
you. Love Actually.
Yeah. He doesn't die in that one either.
Oh, sorry, his wife dies in that one.
Well, she was already dead.
Boy, you guys are spoiling everything.
Well, if she was dead from the start of the movie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There are others where, like, literally he teaches somebody something.
Then
like
there's the gray where he might die.
Uh-huh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But you know what? It's okay to like something.
Sure.
Mm-hmm. Unless it's the Phantom Menace.
You never know what someone's reasoning is.
Yeah.
You just never know.
But I don't understand it. Like, if someone came up to me in person and said that, I'd be, like, real dubious of their moral character. But
well, it's,
I would ask them questions and find out why.
It's just like there are certain movies I can watch and just be, you know, plenty of movies I can go, I see why people don't like Rogue One. I like Rogue One. Mm-hmm. I can see why people don't like it. Mm-hmm. You know, there's plenty of movies like Empire. It is beyond my comprehension. I can watch it and not be like, this is a absolutely fantastic movie.
Yeah.
You know, like Children of Men. There are people like, man, it's like when they talk about the long takes, they're like, all I could think about was how they were making it and how the camera, how did this guy move out of the way of the camera in the backseat of the car? And it's like, eat a fucking dick, you piece of shit. Can you enjoy anything in your life? You know, because there's just plenty of movies that I just watch and I'm like, I don't comprehend how anyone could not enjoy this.
Yeah.
And Empire is one of them. And Phantom Menace, like, that's a movie where I can see, watch it and go, how can anyone enjoy this? How? But plenty mm-hmm. of people do.
Yeah, I mean, that's the only, I mean, and there are moments that are decent in the movie, but to me, that's like the only Star Wars movie I can categorically say is bad.
Yes.
Like, just bad. I mean, I can even defend Attack of the Clones and Revenge of the Sith a little bit.
Yeah.
One of my coworkers, she's 25. Yeah, 25. Her favorite is Revenge of the Sith. I'm like,
yeah.
At least it's not Phantom Menace.
Revenge of the Sith at least has some high drama and some legit, like, you know, I mean, that movie goes some places.
It just surprises, like, it takes me by surprise when anybody says any one of the prequels is their favorite. So it's like, what?
Yeah.
Okay, at least mm-hmm. it's not the shitty one.
Yeah.
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 The real shitty
one. At least it's not the shitty one.
Of course.
Have they, because I have not gone back and have they replaced physical Yoda in The Phantom Menace with CG Yoda? Yes. Fuck.
Wait, they did?
Oh, in Phantom Menace.
Okay.
Yeah, they used the better looking CG one and not the dead-eyed puppet.
Okay.
That looked terrible.
All right.
What, is that on the Blu-rays?
Yes.
Oh, okay. I
actually, I think with the DVDs they did it too. Or when they, like, when the re-release.
I mean, I know 2 and 3 went to the CG model, but I couldn't remember if they had gone back and
replaced
the puppet.
They did go back in one and replace the puppet.
Okay.
Yeah, there's a few things they fixed.
Hmm. See, I wouldn't call that fixed. I like the puppet.
Why?
Because it's consistent with 4, 5, and 6.
No, it's not.
No, it was no, bad. That puppet, was a bad puppet.
Was it?
That puppet was terrible.
Maybe I'm just blanking on it because fuck everything in that movie.
But. No.
Okay, fair enough.
I mean, it's weird because, like, the movies don't take place that much in the past, but they made him look like 400 years younger. It's really bizarre. Like, it's like mm-hmm. he wouldn't have aged that much. Mm. If he's 900 years? Wait, what old does he say he is? 900 years old you reach in Empire?
Yeah.
I'm mm-hmm. just saying, like, that's like 30 years in the future, and you're going to tell me, like, you aged that much?
Yeah.
Or 30 years in the past, whatever.
But either way, like, CG can't replace, like, him in Jedi when he shows up for 5 minutes. Like, that little thing's alive.
Yeah.
You know?
Oh, absolutely.
It's just like I talk about Gremlins when they got that puppet in the kitchen. That thing's alive. There's no way you can tell me that isn't a living, breathing creature sitting there.
Oh, you like Gremlins?
Eating that cookie. That thing is, that's a living thing. And like, where they found that living creature to perform that scene, I don't know.
Yeah, and that's Yoda, like, when he's just laying in that bed, you know, looking away from Luke. CG will never replace that.
Yep.
Okay. So. Anyway.
Hmm.
Man.
Mm-hmm. We talked a lot about Star Wars this
half. Yeah, we got some other emails, but we talked enough, and it's just been the Star Wars half, so.
Sorry.
No, it's fine.
I started this.
It's going to happen.
You know what? People like Star Wars.
Star Wars is good.
And maybe we'll get some new fans if we mention, hey, guys, we talked about Star Wars for the whole podcast.
Yeah, we shit on a lot of it. Good job.
I think we all sucked off Empire for 20 minutes.
You know what?
Deservedly
it deserved it.
I mean, I hate being this way about Star Wars. I really don't like it when geek people are like, I like a thing, but here's what I don't like. This, mm-hmm. this. And it's like, you kind of sound like you don't like the thing.
Yeah.
Like, but I don't know. Like, yeah, it's a weird thing. Because, I mean, I've heard people are like, just fucking hate Return of the Jedi. And I'm like, lesser than the other two? Yes. But hate? I mean, if you have a problem with the Ewoks, you have a problem with the Ewoks, but the beginning is fucking awesome, and the very end is fucking awesome.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Yeah. Like I said, different things appeal to different people. Never know.
Takes all kinds.
Yeah. So.
Speaking of all kinds.
Yeah.
You can find all kinds of our social stuff at bmfcast.com. Click on the buttons on the right-hand side. There's, you know, a bunch of them. They'll do all the things. Send us an email. Send us an email. bmf at bmfcast.com. Give us a call on the Garfield phone, 9105-JOCKS-BMF or 905-5623. 556-9263.
Good. So fast you threw it too quick.
Just skipping. Hot skipping. And stop by our Patreon if you'd like to support what we do. Help. My brain is just fast-forwarding through this.
Mm-hmm.
Stop by our Patreon at patreon.com/BMFcast. If you want to support what we do, you can just throw a couple bucks at us or $1.
And you're going to get a lot.
Yeah, you get a lot.
Or join Magical Gold Club at $5 a month where you will get a plethora of podcasts.
Right. It goes
actual plethora. Like, there's might be too many.
If you pay $0, you get the regular BMF cast, and, you know, you get some extras here and there, and that's pretty good.
Mm-hmm.
If you pay $1, you get a shitload more.
Yep.
If you pay $5, you get more content than you could possibly handle.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
So check that out.
Yeah, and I want to note at one of the higher levels, David Billington, just want to thank him. For being a patron.
Yep.
Thanks, David.
We said you can get a shout out for anything you want. And mm-hmm. all he said was just my name, nothing fancy.
Thanks, Dave.
Say his name.
So thanks, David.
David Billington.
Appreciate you, David.
Yeah.
You're cool.
Thanks so much.
We do appreciate you because we don't want no scrubs. I just thought I'd.
TLC.
Let's get them all going here.
What about your friends?
Anyhow. Also, check out the other podcast that we do, which is No Quarters. It's a video game podcast. It's a motherfucking video game podcast at noquarters.net. And check out we do a little live streaming on Monday nights at twitch.tv/noquartersnet,
mm-hmm.
which is pretty fun. So check that out. And I think that's all I want to talk about. I think I'm done.
All right, then.
Well, let's get out of here, shall we?
All right.
I'm Harlow.
I'm Mackie.
I'm BJ.
I'm Chuck.
And this is Bamfcast Out. See you next time, mother bitches.
Mother bitches?
Mother bitches.
I was about to watch some movie where a character started playing that on harmonica. What?
Oh, it was Battle Beyond the Stars.
And I was like, wait, why do I know this? Wait, what?
Like, sweet.
Man.
Yeah.
Lively chat tonight.
Lively. Yeah, chat's going off.
A lot
off.
Of people in there.
It's because we talked about Star Wars.
No, there was lively before we got there.
That's true.
I think it was because we were...
Place was lively before we arrived.
Yeah. People like monkey.
Yeah, we talked about Rogue One, talked about Rogue Titties.
Uh-huh.
There were some Rogue Titties.
But there was only one Rogue Titty.
Yeah.
Rogue One.
I'd say they were more like Ranger Titties. I mean, if we were going to place her into a class.
More like what?
Ranger Titties. She wasn't so much a rogue as she was a ranger. Oh. Yeah.
Okay. I don't know.
D&D classes. Come on, man.
Yeah. I just don't know how you qualify.
So, wait, she was Chaotic Titty?
Well, she wasn't stealing anything. That's roguelike. I mean, actual roguelike, not roguelike. Like...
Yeah.
Hey guys.
Hey. All right. Chuck's doing a lean cast.
Yeah.
What's going on? Huh?
So, good night, chat.
We appreciate you. Thanks for stopping by.
Yeah.
Stay classy.
We'll see you next week.
You're the best.
On Tuesday.
Around. Right. Next week. Tuesday cast.
Tuesday next week.
Shit, hopefully everybody... Well, we'll have to put it on the Twitters.
Yeah, it'll be on all everything. We'll mention it.
People will know.
See, BJ, if you want to do something next Wednesday, you can.
Go for it.
I'm planning it.
Yeah.
Now, like, there will be nothing happening next Wednesday.
No, I know what's
it will be devoid of social occasions.
Satisfies.
I'm hoping
may I hold the Gremlin's mug? I want to feel the weight.
It's not a bad mug.
Not a bad mug.
Like that could be problematic. I feel like you might get
it's
sudden
a little
inrush.
The aliens one is much more rounded, apparently, from what I saw in the pictures.
I mean, because I kind of want to do a funnel thing with the ear, but I feel like there's a little divot there that you could
it's designed to be straws.
Wow. That works. Strong alcohol is dangerous, though.
I think that's an urban legend. I don't think it's true.
Okay.
ROUSs, I don't think they exist.
What?
That's
the drinking through the straw gets you drunk faster thing. I don't think that's true.
I think that only works if you haven't mixed your drink well and all the alcohol's at the bottom.
It works with beer.
I don't
really.
Okay.
I didn't know.
I haven't figured out a mechanism by which it could work. Like, nobody's explained to me a way in which it could logically work.
I think it has something to do with, it not... You're getting pure liquid and not the air that you would normally get by sucking in. So, you're almost, shotgunning it. Like, something about, the air mixing with it is what I remember here.
You can drink it faster. But...
Yeah, whatever.
Yeah, that hasn't... Nobody's explained that to me scientifically.
Yeah, I think so.
And I've not... I look...